on themselves to get in condition and to live up to their part of what it takes to getting into Winner's Circle.
We're now working on our bodies as hard as the car.
The man's performance has become just as important as the machine.
Pit crew has become as important as the driver.
Pressure and racing. It's unbelievable. And it's not just to get here to victory lane. It's the championship. A championship that's worth over $1 million. And it starts in Daytona. The Daytona 500, they're worrying about the championship. And it increases every race. And the short tracks add to it with their close quarters and intensity.
Position means everything on a short track.
I think the short tracks show that we're only human beings, that we have emotions too.
And a short track gets slick, and because of that, nobody wants to give anything, and that creates a lot of problems.
It's a shame. We had a fast race car. People just don't use their heads sometimes.
I've been in a wreck and I'm left down. I try to give the guys, you know, there's not a lot of room here anyway. Takes us right out of the points and everything.
Everything.
ESPN, the world's leader in motorsports coverage, presents Speed World. Today, live from North Wilkesboro Speedway in North Carolina, it's the First Union 400 NASCAR Winston Cup Race. And you could not ask for more perfect weather conditions, hardly a cloud in the sky, zero chance of rain, and a very comfortable 68 degrees. Here's what pressure is all about. The quest for the cup standings. Dale Earnhardt leads Rusty Wallace by 47. Every driver in the top five of points has at least one win here at North Wilkesboro. In the second five, there you find Dale Jarrett, 177 points behind, certainly not out of the championship. And the second five also includes rookie Jeff Gordon. Hi, everyone. I'm Bob Jenkins. Welcome to North Wilkesboro. Now, each year, three pressure-packed short track races are run during the spring, three during the fall. This is the second of the year here at the 5/8 mile oval at North Wilkesboro. It's interesting to note that Earnhardt and Wallace have accumulated the most points in short track racing over the past 5 years. Let's get more on this story as we go pit side, and here's John Kernan.
Thank you, Bob. Well, yes, Rusty and Dale are locked in an early season points battle, and today at North Wilkesboro, Rusty has a little bit of a head start. He is starting ninth, Earnhardt back here in the 21st position, but Dale has the fastest race car in the field. And ironically, he broke Rusty's old qualifying record here at North Wilkesboro yesterday in second round qualifying with a lap of 117.6 miles an hour. And Dale, I tell you, after that lap you turned yesterday, you had a smile all across your face.
Well, it really felt good to come back and run good the second day after having such a bad first day and not making the race. But the car was really hooked up. We did a few things to it, Andy and the guys, and we tuned on it. And it really hooked that second lap and run a good lap.
Now, you have the fastest car in the field, but you got 20 guys in front of you. Can you afford to be careful in the early stages of the race, or can you charge right to the front?
Well, you got to be a little careful here and work, hopefully get by some of these cars and work your way to the front and get in there with the front leaders. It's going to be a long day, even though it's just 400 laps here, but it's a tight race here and a lot of fun if you just be cool.
Dale Earnhardt looking to have a lot of fun. He starts 21st today. Of course, the big story this weekend, the return of Alan Kulwicki Racing. And with more on that, here's Dr. Jerry Punch.
Thank you very much, John. You know, it was Alan Kulwicki's wish that Ridgeway, Virginia driver Jimmy Hensley drive his car if he were ever incapacitated. Unbeknownst to Hensley, Kulwicki had developed quite an admiration for Hensley's ability to save a car and push the button only when he had to, much as Alan had to do back when times were very lean. Now, it's been well documented Hooters Restaurant just pulled away from the team, citing a difference in philosophies as to the direction they were headed. So this team almost didn't get here, but up stepped some people like Purolator, an associate sponsor, and Wheel Help, and Nick Campbell, the CEO for Bojangles Restaurants in Charleston. Hey, I've already got a race team with Derek Cope, but I'm a fan. I want Alan Kulwicki's wishes to be fulfilled, so I will sponsor the car for here, Martinsville, and Talladega. But I don't need the exposure, so let's put my favorite charities on the car. So on the front of the car, Easter seals, and on the very back of the car, a sign for the Shriners Hospital for Crippled Children. What will happen to this race team? Where will it go after Talladega? Well, a lot of that could depend on what happens here today. Bob?
All right, Jerry. Well, pressure was evident yesterday when Les Richter and Gary Nelson met with Ricky Rudd and Brett Bodine separately and together to warn them to show more respect for each other on the racetrack. Both drivers agreed to forget about the past and look toward the future. Our Speed World coverage is being brought to you by Quaker State. The big Q is one tough motor oil. By Allied Signals Auto Light Spark Plugs, guaranteed for 2 years no matter how far you go. And by Goodyear, number one in tires. A look at the starting lineup and a closer look at North Wilkesboro Speedway when we return.
Over the years, I've made a lot of trips back and forth to Vegas.
So how's it going this trip, George?
The odometer was broken for over 50,000 miles, so I say we've got 300,000 miles on this car.
Hi, George.
This beauty's a living example of what can be done with proper maintenance and AC Delco.
Hi, George.
AC Delco parts, it's like buying time.
Now through May 15th, get started with up to $14 cash back on Delco Freedom batteries.
Back at North Wilkesboro Speedway for the First Union 400, race number 7 on the 93 Winston Cup schedule. Well, here's our look at North Wilkesboro Speedway. It's 0.625 miles in length. 117.017 was the pole speed time, 19.228 seconds, and we'll go 400 laps. Our bush track description, well, North Wilkesboro is a 5/8 mile oval. The banking in turns 1 and 2, 14 degrees. You come off of that onto a relatively flat backstretch, banked at only 3 degrees, and the length of the backstretch is 670 feet. Turns 3 and 4, just about the same as turn 1 and 2.
Yes, the banking is the same at 14, but when you come off of turn 4, Bob, you go downhill into turn 1. Of course, when you come off of turn 2, you go uphill into turn 3. Presents quite a challenge to the teams in setting the cars up so they work well on both ends of the track.
Pace car getting ready to pull out and lead these cars around here for a couple of laps before we get the green flag. There's the pole sitter, Brett Bodine. We'll give you the starting lineup here in just a moment as the field rolls away. Here is the AC Delco starting lineup. Brett Bodine is on the pole with a speed of 117.017 in the Quaker State Ford. Alongside his brother, Jeff Bodine, in the Motorcraft Ford, qualifying at 116.677. Ernie Irvin will start third in the Kodak Film Chevrolet, car number 4. He's from Modesto, California. Ken Schrader will flank him in the Kodiak Chevrolet, car number 25. The McDonald's 4, driven by Hut Strickland, will go next, car number 27. Terry Labonte will start in sixth position. He's from Corpus Christi, Texas, and drives the Kellogg's Chevrolet. Rookie Jeff Gordon from Pittsboro, Indiana, has the 7th starting position in the number 24 DuPont Chevrolet. And then Sterling Marlin from Columbia, Tennessee, in the number 8 Raybestos Ford. 9th starting position goes to Rusty Wallace in the Miller Genuine Drag car number 2. Alongside will be Ricky Rudd from Chesapeake, Virginia, in the Tide Chevrolet car number 5. Dale Jarrett is next in the 11th starting position in the Interstate Battery Chevrolet car number 18, then the Valvoline 4, driven by Mark Martin from Batesville, Arkansas. The rest of the starting lineup as a near-capacity crowd gets set for 400 laps of racing on this 5/8 mile oval here at North Wilkesboro.
Some awfully good drivers starting back in the field. We saw Bill Elliott. Here's Morgan Shepherd, one of the winners this year. Harry Gant, who's the previous winner here at North Wilkesboro, starting back in the 10th row.
And there is Dale Earnhardt, the 21st starter with the new track record.
And Darrell Waltrip, who won 3 races last year, started back in row 12.
Darrell Waltrip has the most wins on this racetrack, 10.
And Davey Allison, who won 5 races last year in row 14 alongside Phil Parsons.
There in row 13 is Rick Mast. This is his 100th NASCAR Winston Cup start. And the field has been given the signal for one more lap to go. 4 drivers came here, did not make the race. They were Dave Marcus, Jay Hedgecock, Jimmy Horton, and James Hilton. There's the in-car camera that will be carried by Rusty Wallace in the Miller Genuine Draft Pontiac. He's starting in 9th position. There is Mark Martin in the Valvoline Ford number 6, getting the tires warmed up as they go down the backstretch. And in the number 7 car, driven by Jimmy Hensley, will also have an in-car camera. This is a big race for Jimmy. We wish him and all the other competitors the best of luck as we get set for NASCAR Winston Cup racing on this Sunday afternoon here in the Brushy Mountains. And it is absolutely beautiful here weather-wise. The crowd is on its feet cheering the start of the race. The green flag is out, and here we go. Jeff Bodine spinning, so is Ernie Irvin here in the opening lap. And Mark Martin tags Jeff Bodine hard, and there is a fire burning at the back of Mark Martin's car. This incident in turn number 4, Jeff Bodine getting sideways and then was collected by several others, and quite a fire, it appears, burning on the racetrack itself.
It's just a racetrack itself. There's not a car there. All the cars have left except Mark Martin, and we can see just how much damage that Mark has to the right side of that car.
He's still flying off of it. Boy, there is a tremendous amount. The housing is broken, I believe, Benny.
There's no wheel at all on Mark Martin's car. He's the guy that was losing the gasoline, and look at all those sparks.
Here's a replay of what happened as the cars are weighed through turns 3 and 4.
Looks like Jeff
Bodine on the outside came down. He and Ernie Irvin made slight contact. Both of them go around. Now, Jeff's car hits the wall. We can see the damage up there, but he comes back across, and Mark Martin has no place to go. There goes the tire, Ned.
Yeah.
It's leaving. He's broke the house in two, and we can see the gasoline catching on fire.
And there is Jeff Bodine's damage. He was the winner of the most recent race here at North Wilkesboro last fall. And there is Mark Martin, whose car is badly damaged on the right side, hardly any damage at all on the left. Here it is once again.
Just a slight touch in the left rear, and around goes Jeff up and backs in the wall pretty good. Now the rest of these cars trying to get through, they do get through, but when Jeff comes back across the racetrack, Mark Martin has nowhere to go.
Dale Jarrett just barely escaping.
And there's Jimmy, is that Jimmy
Hensley?
Yeah,
I believe it is. Yeah.
Jimmy Hensley just barely getting through the crash.
Dick Trickle was also involved. That's the white car up there to the left of your screen.
Morgan Shepherd, Kyle, that's Morgan Shepherd there, the white car, and Kyle Petty, they both got slowed down and got through, and Martin is headed to the garage area. They have a lot of work to do on the Valvoline Ford.
And Jeff Bodine is in the pits. We didn't want to see the in-car camera used for a trip back to the garage area, but that's the case with Mark Martin. Jerry?
Well, Mark Martin has gone by us toward the garage area. Jeff Bodine's car pitting right at the entrance of the garage area. They were going to come down and pull the sheet metal away, change tires and send him out, but that will not happen now. Take a look at the left rear of Jeff Bodine's car. Oil now pouring from beneath the car. Apparently, they have either a rupture in one of the oil lines or maybe the oil tank, so they put tires on it, and now they will wheel him back toward the garage area. As they come by, I can see that it is the oil tank and some of the lines that have been punctured in the left side of that car. Some 16 quarts of oil that tank holds, and now they will make their way back to the garage area to see if they can get the car fixed. Jeff Bodine still sitting in the car as we watch him. Maybe we can try to get a comment with Jeffrey quickly. As they're working on Ernie Irvin's car, they're also working on the Mark Martin car. Jeff still sitting in the car and apparently just very, very upset, very stoic in the car as the crew working now on the rear of that machine.
Not a good way to celebrate your 44th birthday. That's the situation with Jeff Bodine. Last fall, this race ran without a caution at all, and the first came out on lap number 1 here today.
Reynolds, we're Quaker State.
The big Q stands for quality. Always has, always will. We'll
You know, when it comes to protecting against friction, nothing beats Quaker State. When it comes to protecting against viscosity breakdown, nothing beats Quaker State. When it comes to keeping engines clean, nothing beats Quaker State. Take it from me, for honorable protection, nothing beats Quaker State. It's one tough motor oil.
Oil. It's the lifeblood of your engine. That makes your oil filter your engine's most vital organ. That's why Fram keeps going the extra mile to make the best protection even better. The Fram Extra Guard Oil Filter. Unique glass fiber paper stops more dirt than any other filter for the best protection ever. Fram Extra Guard. American or import, it's an extra lease on life.
Imagine this is a sidewall of a tire. The whole idea is to keep the tread area in level contact with the road, or you'll lose traction, especially in cornering. Now, Goodyear has learned a lot in NASCAR racing and applied that knowledge to Eagle street radials. In cornering, there's a lot of force trying to lift the tire, but Goodyear Eagle's racing-inspired sidewall design works to hold the tire firmly to the road. Eagle radials, only from Goodyear. We like to say the best tires in the world have Goodyear written all over them.
Watching at some activity back in the garage area. This is what the championship is all about, trying to get the car back on the racetrack to complete as many laps as possible. We're watching Mark Martin's crew doing the work on his car.
And you see that fluid, that is brake fluid, not gasoline that's coming out of there. He has broken the brake line off the right rear, and that's what we saw coming out.
Ben, what allowed them to get back with one wheel only pulling?
I can't imagine.
John Burns down there with Mark.
A very disappointed Mark Martin, and Mark, you're okay, but man, the crew's got a lot of work to do to this race car to get you back out there.
Yeah, man, it's over today. We had a great car, in practice. I believe we might have had a shot at it, but we can't win any races like this, that's for sure. I don't know. Jeff spun out, and I don't know why I couldn't see. I guess I started too far back. You need to start on the front row today the way they wreck these cars.
Mark, Benny and the guys up in the booth were wondering, with just one rear wheel, how were you able to drive it around the racetrack and get it back here?
It wasn't that bad. I thought I was going to wreck it going into the first turn. I was going faster than I should have been, but...
Hey, John, go back and look at that thing.
I didn't know I had a wheel gone, so I was just driving it, you know?
You didn't even know you had a fire back here, did you?
I knew there was a fire. My spotter told me to get out. Shoot, I wanted to get it running, that was the best thing, just to get away from the fire. Real unfortunate. I'm a little embarrassed that we can't start a race and not have a wreck, you know. I mean, that's not real professional looking, but the last race we had there wasn't any cautions for 400 laps, so I guess sometimes it goes good, sometimes it doesn't.
Well, there's always next week in crew. Now let's go back to pit road and Dr. Jerry Punch.
Actually, John, we're back in the garage area across from where you are on the other side, and Jeff Bodine still sitting in the Motorcraft 4. Jeffrey, a tough break for you. What happened at the start?
I don't really know. I just got turned around going into turn three, you know. The place is so tight, everything's so crowded. Yeah, I got bumped a little bit, and just the tires weren't warmed up, and it just got sideways and spun around. Unfortunately, a lot of cars got in that wreck. You know, I was kind of spinning around in front of everybody, and that's a bad place to be when you're on the outside pole. But whenever you get in these kind of situations, you try to fix it, trying to get back out there, get some points. You know, we're third to points, and that's about all we can do the rest of the day, just try to finish as well as we can and get all the points we can.
Jeff Bodine is still sitting in the car, and if you take a look at the damage at the back of this Motorcraft Ford, fixing this car may be a bigger task than what you may have first thought. The oil tank is punctured. The oil has leaked out. Part of the rear frame has been pushed in. The car has been shortened by about 2.5 feet. The Motorcraft crew, Donnie Wingo and them, certainly will have their work cut out. We're probably looking at 30 to 45 minutes at least to get this car track worthy again, which will cost him some valuable points. Gentlemen.
Jeff Bodine was the winner last fall. Mark Martin was second. They were involved in this crash in turn number 3 on the opening lap.
And as soon as this is from inside Mark Martin's car, in the camera, right behind Rusty Wallace. Everything looks okay. And there we can see Jeff Bodine going around. Jimmy Spencer goes by. And here comes Jeff just no place for Mark to go. And there we see his wheel. Dale Jarrett going, and there's a fire that Derek Cope ran through. Morgan Shepherd.
Well, the cars in front of Mark Martin made it through okay, but he didn't. Here's the bumper cam on Jimmy Hensley's car.
Going down the back straightaway, going in turn three. Bill Elliott, as Jimmy slowed down, Bill hit it and almost spun out. Don't know how he kept the car straight, but he got it down on the inside.
He did a heck of a job, didn't he?
He really did.
And here's from our cameras up on top of the press box.
Of course, as Jeff said, when they went into the turn, he and Ernie Irvin got together. Don't take much when you're headed into the turn. And tapped him, and around he went, and that caused all the problems.
Man.
Well, several cars have damage besides Mark Martin and Jeff Bodine. Nothing real serious. Bill Elliott's a little damage, so's Bobby Hamilton. We're getting set for the restart here at North Wilkesboro.
Lunchtime already. That's why my stomach is talking to me.
No fries.
I'm out, y'all.
Wait, James, bring me back a Big Mac extra value meal.
Make that too.
I'm popping for Kiki.
I can't exploit your manhood like that, my brother.
And McDonald's prices exploit me.
Go, Chuck. I got it.
Allow me.
Could have been to Mickey D's and back by now, y'all.
To make the most of your money, get a whole lot of the food you love in a McDonald's extra value meal.
My treat. Lunch money.
What you want is what you get at McDonald's today.
Budweiser, king of beers.
All the excitement of great high school players, they're going to be getting down, slam dunks, passing. I'm going to have a ball because I'm going to be coaching. The Magic Round Ball Classic, yeah!
Live coverage today on ESPN Speed World of the First Union 400 NASCAR Winston Cup race from North Wilkesboro, North Carolina. We're under caution. In fact, we have not completed one lap under green. In turn number three on the very first lap, a multi-car crash has put Jeff Bodine and Mark Martin back into the garage area, where repairs are being made.
And one car that was involved in that, Ernie Irvin in the Kodak Film Chevrolet, has made repeated pit stops, Bob, and the scoring is now showing him two laps down. He has lost extra time in the pits. Jimmy Hensley now coming down pit road, so is Harry Gant.
Your first Autolite field summary of the day, showing the cars in their order last lap. Dale Earnhardt has moved up some positions from his 21st starting spot, but a lot of that is due to the fact that cars were involved in the accident ahead of him.
And we can see the fellas, all three cars are out of the race.
Apparently NASCAR has indicated that the teams should come in, Jerry, is that right?
Yes, they're going to open up pit road and let everyone come down and check their tires. So much debris from beneath those cars up in turn three and four. You're looking at Jimmy Hensley here in the pits now. The Alan Kulicki Racing Team, they're pulling some sheet metal away from the right side fenders. That's Paul Andrews, who's just pulling on the right front fender where his car was tagged in that melee up in turn three and four. And so NASCAR, their most primary concern in NASCAR, second to competition, safety. They want to make sure these teams have come down pit road, check their tires, check the sheet metal clearance on the short track before they resume green flag racing.
Jerry, apparently they're coming down pit road, as we see there, at their control speed of 35 miles an hour. Are they just getting them closer to the crew members so that they can take that closer look at them?
That's the word we're getting down here, Dan, is that NASCAR wants the crews to be able to take a look at the cars as they come by. They can also look beneath the cars to see if they may have a tire going. Apparently it's very difficult from what we've been told by the Goodyear engineers, it's very difficult for the drivers to determine when one of these radial tires is going down. Unlike the old bias car tire, the car would get a little boggy on the racetrack, but with the radial tire and the new tubeless inner liner, you can't tell until the tire is almost flat. So they want to be able to look at the cars very closely as they come down pit road and determine if there may be a problem with sheet metal rubbing or possibly a tire going down.
All right. The cars this time on the racetrack as they continue under caution. Work is still being done up in turn number four, cleaning up the multi-car tangle on turn lap number one. That has eliminated at least two competitors.
Winters in the North Country can be hard on a vehicle, but spring can be even worse. Your vehicle's shocks and struts can fail over time, posing a handling and a safety problem, not to mention an uncomfortable ride. Your local PartsMaster Master Tech installer can help installing quality PartsMaster shocks and struts by Gabriel. Available for all foreign and domestic cars, light trucks, and RVs. These quality shocks and struts are competitively priced and carry a lifetime warranty. Get back on the road to comfort and safety with PartsMaster. Available at Village Service and Auto Repair, Underhill and Thayer Automotive, South Burlington.
The Spring Into Golf Sale continues at Marty Keene's Golf World.
Hi, I'm Marty Keene. Saturday, April 17th is our Manufacturer Rep Sale Day. Representatives from your favorite golfing companies will be present with new products. Over $3,000 in merchandise will be given away in contests and drawings. A free yearly pass to our indoor range to our first 25 customers and up to 50% off all in-store merchandise. It's our biggest sale day of the year.
The Spring Into Golf Sale has begun at Marty Keene's Golf World.
The NHL is playing for keeps. Watch the Stanley Cup playoffs on ESPN with a hot, delicious Domino's pizza. And oh yeah, get a comfortable seat. The Stanley Cup playoffs coming to a living room near you on ESPN.
Well, we'll be looking forward to next Tuesday night and the start of the hockey playoffs. But tonight, it's exclusive coverage of ESPN Sunday Night Baseball. Andy Van Slyke and Daryl Strawberry, the Pirates against the Dodgers from Dodger Stadium in Los Angeles tonight at 8 o'clock Eastern Time, ESPN's Sunday Night Baseball. Jimmy Spencer has come in. He was a black flag. There's apparently a piece of metal hanging from the car, so he came in and
doesn't have a rear bumper because we saw him going past Mark Martin. He got up there and someone ran in the back of him. Did you ever see Jimmy Spencer? He goes up. He was the first guy to hit Jeff Bodine. I didn't see that before.
Just barely clipped him and took the bumper off. And Jeff continued to come down the track right in front of Mark Martin.
So a NASCAR official walked out to look at the car and make sure all the pieces were secure and send him back out.
18 laps have been completed. Next time around, they'll get the green flag and we'll be racing. And let's go down to Jerry Punch very quickly.
Jimmy, how bad does the car hurt, the Spencer car?
The car's all right. There's just a crush panel that NASCAR thought was a little bit too loose to race. So we just ripped it off and we'll be all right.
Some sheet metal damage to the rear of the car. Number 12, as Spencer has made an entry on the pit road, is back at the rear of the pack as we get set for green flag racing.
There's a team that has really made a good, impressive showing in the first six races of 1993 as Jimmy Spencer is 10th in the point standings. Now the pace cars. Light is out. It makes a hard left onto pit road and the field comes down to take the green flag and hopefully a little bit of racing here as Brett Bodine, the pole sitter of this race in the Quaker State Ford, leads them down.
Pontiac. I think right there is looking to make a pass as well. And Strickland trying to get back down on the inside. He might have done it. I think he did right there in front of Jeff Gordon.
You can't even see the number on the left side of Hunt Strickland's car. With 22 laps to go, it's completely covered with black tire marks. Jeff Gordon right behind Hunt Strickland. Up front, meanwhile, it's a two-car race. Bodine and Ken Schrader. Brad Bodine made his first Winston Cup start in 1987. He suffered Terry Labonte, who broke his shoulder at Darlington. Brad Bodine finished in eighth position. His only NASCAR win has come here on the 5/8 mile of North Wilkesboro.
Here's Morgan Shepherd trying to get by Darrell Walton. Gets on the outside. And here's the pass for the lead. Kenny Schrader, Kodiak Chevrolet, takes the lead.
Ken Schrader has already led four races in 1993. And the
and Jeff Gordon spins going into turn one.
Hard contact.
Yes, he was down on the inside of Hunt Strickland. Back
and again, a fire breaks out. Pretty significant fire blazing at the rear end of the DuPont Chevrolet.
It's just at the rear of the car. It's just at the rear. There was some fire. We see Jeffrey scrambling out of there. Get out of there, baby. There we go.
And he's
running in front of the fire truck there.
Yeah. Yeah, he's okay. Throws up his hand to everybody that he is okay, but his race car is not so well right now. Jeff was racing hard. He had just gone on the inside of Hunt Strickland, got inside him in turns three and four as they put the fire out. And then going into turn one, he cleared Hunt, but I don't know if he got into some of that speedy dry going into the turn or what, but the back end just broke loose and around he went. Let's see if we can see what happens here. There he is on the inside of Hunt Strickland, the McDonald's Ford. And you see, yes, he did. He got into that quick dry down on the inside, got his left wheels on it, and he just broke traction and up into the wall he went.
And we can see the gasoline come out of the car, and it ignites. I'll tell you, thank goodness for fuel cells. You know, they just, those rubber gas tanks, they break the top out of the gas tank, and some gasoline will come out, but it just doesn't break that gas tank.
And here's Strickland on pit road.
Yeah, he was having some problems, handling problems or something, because we had seen him there lose several positions as the car was getting a little out of shape, and then he was beginning to slip underground a little bit more. You can see they're putting some new Goodyear on there, so hopefully it'll straighten his problems out.
We can see where he's had some contact. I guess that was with Ricky Rudd, or I guess that was with Labonte. And they're back on the right rear, get in that sheet metal away from that right rear tire.
Yeah, that right rear was contact with the wall when Labonte was down on the inside of him. So he's getting it from both sides.
Well, we've had two accidents here in the first 27 laps of this race, the most recent involving rookie Jeff Gordon.
The Suzuki Tritana 600, easily identified flying object.
When 280 seemed out of reach, it's Joe Amato and Autolite who punch it. It goes to 290. Connie Coletta and Autolite smash it. 300, the barrier. Kenny Bernstein and Autolite shatter it. Autolite and the record breakers. We feel pretty good about that.
Mountain man survival skills. The basics. A true mountain man must have a keen sense of direction, a certain physical dexterity, and a talent for surviving the most unforgiving climates. Of course, nothing is more key to a mountain man's survival than plenty of smooth bush beer and easy drinking bush light. So, head for the mountains and learn how the mountain man survives even the most grueling conditions.
How far will your money go when buying a Katana 600? Introducing Suzuki Get On It Flexible Financing. Want to see it again? Other programs include zero down, low monthly payments, and first-time buyer. Get on it.
At the First Union 400 at North Wilkesboro Speedway in North Carolina, we're looking from behind the Pontiac pace car. In our second caution period, the most recent one brought out by an accident involving Jeff Gordon. Here's Jerry.
Well, rookie sensation Jeff Gordon has made his way back to the garage area. And Jeffrey, first of all, heck of a lick. Are you okay?
Yeah, I'm fine. You know,
and it tore the car up pretty bad. What happened was I come, you know, got underneath Hutch Strickland down the back straightaway. We rubbed a few times, got into 3 and 4, and he come down on me, and we just rubbed a little bit more, and I got underneath him, come down the front straightaway, went and hit the brakes, and the pedal just went to the floor. I pumped it up. Must have broke a brake line or something when we got together. I don't know how it could have, but what happened, but it just drove into turn one with no brakes, and I finally got some pressure enough to get the car sideways, and it backed it in the wall, and just tore the thing up pretty bad.
Well, Jeff Gordon able to smile. They're waiting for the car to come back to the garage area as he's headed over to talk to Ray Evernham, his crew, and Rick Hendrick and the crew waiting on the DuPont Chevrolet to come in the garage area, but a tough break for a very talented young driver.
Jeff Gordon, certainly with a bright future ahead of him, finding the Winston Cup circuit, well, a little bit tougher maybe than he had anticipated. Had a great run a couple of times during this year, but he's also had some very tough luck in some races.
In fact, Bob, he's had good runs in every race, and especially those that he finished, but this is his fourth DNF, did not finish so far this year, and that really hurts you as far as
sure
points. You pointed out that he was in 10th place in the points coming into this race, but he has been very impressive.
So that means that the crews will go to work on this car, and obviously they're going to have to do a lot of work on the car to get it ready. And of course, the pit crews, as we have indicated already today, are in much better shape to be. Here is a track fact. Track facts are brought to you by Quaker State. The Big Q is one tough motor oil.
At Bristol, Tennessee, we saw an incredible 16-second four-tire stop by Rusty Wallace's crew. That stop, in conjunction with others almost as fast, allowed Rusty Wallace to go to victory lane. So we decided to journey here to Penske Racing South and try to determine the secret behind the speed. Well, to no one's surprise, it's an exercise room. But here it's a little bit different than maybe what some of the other teams might have. They employ an exercise specialist, Bob Presley, who accentuates two things, speed and flexibility. Not bulk, not muscle size, but primarily the ability to do something in a hurry with agility. Now, they work out here 5 days a week. Included with this, they use a Stairmaster and a treadmill, as well as weights. Then they go out in the parking lot in the afternoons and run wind sprints. They run the width of the parking lot and walk the length. Then they run those dreaded line drills where you go back and forth like a basketball player hates, where you bend over and learn to change directions in a hurry. And then every Tuesday night, yes, they have aerobics class here, trying to teach this over-the-wall gang to be graceful. So when we call those pit stops high-speed ballets, that's exactly what they are here at Penske Racing South.
Well, the pit crews are now getting in shape. The drivers, of course, always are staying in top physical conditioning. How about the ex-drivers and now broadcasters? Benny, are you on any
I'm on a seafood diet. Yeah. All the food I see, I eat it, so...
He hasn't eaten anything for 24 hours. He's doing that well.
Jerry, what do you have to add?
Well, I could comment. You know, Benny, we mentioned Benny has had a bit of a under the weather for the weekend here, and he came to me for advice. I said, Benny, clear liquids. You got to stay on clear liquids. You'll feel better. Benny, hush puppies are not a clear liquid.
You learn something today,
man. Those all liquid diets are tough, aren't they? There is Jeff Bodine, who of course was involved in that first lap incident. He's back on the track trying to get as many Winston Cup points as possible.
Burt Reynolds talks with the Quaker State team.
Bodine, I gotta get my name on the car. My fans are getting restless.
No room.
How about on the Big Q?
The Big Q stands alone. Stands for quality.
You can't get better protection.
No other oil beats Quaker State.
How about right here?
No way. Red doesn't like to be crowded.
My fans are getting demanding.
All right. We'll go get the painter.
I must have had a hard time finding the painter. Nothing beats Quaker State. It's one tough motor oil.
If today was like this, then tomorrow should be like this. Spend the day, spend the night, spend the weekend. Marble Island Resort is open to the public at Mallets Bay on beautiful Lake Champlain in Colchester.
Adelphia Cable, the people who are dedicated to bringing you and your family quality programming and great service, are also your friends and neighbors who care about our community. Adelphia provides the opportunity during work hours for employees like Joe, Amy, Mary, and Ted to volunteer their time as blood and apheresis donors at the American Red Cross. It's people that serve you and your community every day that makes Adelphia Cable so special.
Because we're concerned.
ESPN, top-ranked boxing. Mayweather battles Padilla. Former two-time world champion Roger Mayweather must win if he wants a shot at his third world championship. He faces the very dangerous and unpredictable Zach Padilla. Top-ranked boxing, Saturday night at midnight Eastern, live on ESPN.
We're back in North Wilkesboro. A lap and a half has been completed under green. Kent Schrader is the leader of this race. Brett Bodine is running second, followed by Sterling Marlin, Terry Labonte, and Ricky Rudd. Now, out in front of Kent Schrader, is Ernie Irvin. He's gotten one of his laps back.
He came in, took on fresh tires, Bob, and was able to sprint out ahead of Kent Schrader, pull away from him when he started the race. Or the restart of the race, I should say.
Looks like these new tires are very important here at North Wilkesboro, just like they have been in all the racetracks this year, Ned.
Yep, after we get some laps on them, they get heated up a little bit and don't run quite as fast.
Here's Kyle Petty and Davey Allison battling for position. This would be back in 17th spot. There's Phil Parsons right ahead of them now. Kyle looks to the inside into turn number three. Cannot pick up the spot.
I talked to Davey Allison and Larry McReynolds this morning. They changed four springs. They wasn't happy with their car at all, and they changed four springs this morning trying to find that combination to get around the speedway.
Keeping you up to date on who's running where in our Auto Life Field Summary. Earnhardt is up to 10th.
Yeah, he's up to 10th, but he's being passed right now. Bass. Earnhardt had moved from his 21st position up to 10th. But Rick Bass now trying to move on the inside of him. There they are in turn one. Bass in the Skoll Classic Ford.
He gets it done.
Yep. Jordan Shepherd right behind Earnhardt. Right up ahead of them, Bill Elliott's trying to move around Derek Coates.
Jeff Bodine, 27 laps down, but still in competition. There is Bill Elliott and Derek Cope racing side by side for a moment before Elliott made the pass successfully.
That was eighth position that Elliott just took over.
So Bill, despite the fact his car was damaged, is going pretty good. And here are Petty and Allison once again, side by side through turns three and four.
Looks like Davey's car is working pretty good on the outside. Let's see if he can hang with Kyle through this corner.
Yeah, sure does. Pretty good.
Gets a good grip off that corner. He might have found himself a groove. And Kyle finally takes the spot away. Here's a race for second place. Sterling Marlin on the inside of Brett Bodine.
Bodine was the pole sitter, led the first few laps before Schrader took over, and now he is about to lose second spot as Marlin in the Rafestas Ford is battling with the Quaker State Ford. Ford doesn't have a real impressive record here overall. However, Ford did win both races on this speedway in 1992. Davey Allison won this race a year ago, and Jeff Bodine won in the fall. Now Marlin has passed Brett Bodine, and Terry Labonte will be challenging Brett next. Meanwhile, back of that group of cars, here is Dale Earnhardt and Derry Cope with Darrell Waltrip right behind Earnhardt. Dale trying to get that Chevy to the inside of Cope. Can't do it.
Now Darrell Waltrip came up past Morgan Shepherd on the outside.
Here we go. Oh, they're both sideways.
They get them squared away. Let's go at it again here in turn three. Let's see. Derek gives Earnhardt some running room down there. And Darrell Waltrip will move up there as well as Earnhardt makes the pass.
Boy, the short tracks are so tough. You can see when you get out of the groove, that preferred line around the racetrack right on the bottom. It's slow going. Derek Coatman already lost. This is the third position he's lost.
That's Morgan Shepherd. Now the 15 car, of course, is Jeff Bodine, and he is many laps down, so he's not taking a lot of points from Derek. Behind Cope, Kyle Petty, and Kenny Wallace.
With both these cars, both these punted by Felix Sabatis.
And there, of course, on the right side of your screen is Davey Allison.
Davey Allison going back to pass now.
Comes Michael Waltrip as in front of these guys. Here is Earnhardt on the outside of the track now.
Yeah, but he got up there in that groove. Darrell Waltrip went past him, and now Morgan Shepherd trying to go past him.
Earnhardt's losing position, just like Ned said.
Yeah, that his car is not working as well as it did yesterday when he set a new track record in the second round qualifying.
More on Dale Earnhardt from John Kernan.
Well, guys, you talk about Dale's record qualifying run yesterday. It was under cloud cover. It was very cool. Late day practice yesterday. The sun did come out, but it was still very cool. Today, the temperature's probably 10, 15 degrees warmer than it was yesterday. The sun is out. The problem that Earnhardt's having right now is getting off of the corners. The tires are not locking up. They're not grabbing hold. So he's spinning the tires. He's not getting that little shot coming out of the corner.
Well, somebody who did get a shot a lap or so ago was Sterling Marlin, who has passed Ken Schrader and become the third leader of this event.
And this car, the 8 car, the Rebestos Ford in Darlington, South Carolina, had a great race car. In Bristol, they had a great race car, but something happened to them. I told Kenny Wilson Friday, I said, if you guys ever finish a race, I think you're going to do well. And I saw this Tabola brothers here, Mickey and Bill, this morning. At least they're here to enjoy this great run that Sterling has going.
Bit of a separation between second place Ken Schrader and back here third, fourth, and fifth, Bodine, Labonte, and Rudd.
Yeah, right behind them, Dale Jarrett just went around Rusty Wallace. I believe Brett is holding up Terry Labonte a little bit, but he's doing a good job of keeping the groove. But they've been all over him for several laps here now.
Terry Labonte has won twice on this racetrack, Bodine once, and Rudd never won a race here at North Wilkesboro.
Labonte tried to get a nose under Bodine, but just couldn't quite do it.
And the 6 car, Mark Martin, just pulled back out of the garage here. He's heading back on the racetrack to the new rear house, and there he goes.
He's going to be about 55 laps down.
So Mark Martin is back in the fray here at North Wilkesboro. The first Union 400 being led right now by Sterling Marlin with Ken Schrader second. We'll be right back.
This all-surface vehicle goes wherever it wants to. These all-purpose vehicles go wherever you want to. When you're on Goodyear ESA all-surface radials with triple traction, you get an area for quiet highway traction, for wet weather traction, and for rugged off-road traction from Goodyear. Wherever you drive, off the road, down the highway, wet or dry, try a set of all-surface Goodyear Wranglers. You'll know why we like to say the best tires in the world have Goodyear written all over them.
Not taking a break, are you?
No break.
You smell good.
Well, thank you.
You wearing something?
Just my deodorant.
Oh, that Suave Super Stick I got you.
Yeah.
You like the Suave, huh?
Yeah.
Good. It costs less than your other one.
Yeah, well, I think it works really well. Don't you think so? You're supposed to be paying attention to me right now.
How many women tell their husbands they smell good while they're cleaning out the garage?
Just one.
That's right.
Yeah.
Super Stick. When Suave works this well, why spend more?
Welcome to NAPA, America's most complete source for quality auto parts and accessories. And now get hot spring buys at NAPA. Quality NAPA motor oil, just 99 cents a quart. Get two NAPA Silverline oil filters, just $4. STP oil treatment is free after double mail-in rebate. And don't miss this special value. NAPA's five-piece cooler combo, just $19.99. Save big on hot spring buys now at NAPA, America's first choice.
To get here, you gotta start here.
Troy Aikman, quarterback, UCLA.
Dallas selects Emmitt Smith, running back from...
The NFL Draft, Sunday, April 25th, live on ESPN.
Here are the top five and the interval in which they are separated. Schrader is a little more than a second behind. Brett Bodine is 2.5 seconds behind. Labonte, 3 seconds. And Ricky Rudd, 3.25 seconds behind the leader, Sterling Marlin. And he comes up now to put a lap on Bobby Labonte. Here's Jerry Punch with a comment on Sterling Marlin.
You may not know it to look at Sterling Marlin right now, but even though that car was the one he ran at Bristol and it was fixed, Sterling isn't exactly 100%. He thought he had some broken ribs from contact he had at Bristol, Tennessee 2 weeks ago. He's been very uncomfortable in the car. He said, really, I'm okay in the car, Doc. He said, but if I hit anything, it's really going to hurt. So obviously the advice I gave him from a medical expert was, don't hit anything.
Very good, Jerry. Now, see, even I...
How many years of school do you reckon Punch went through this?
Hey, that Ford is hooked up today. It's looking good.
And as you mentioned, Benny, it has had some very good runs this year. But when you look at the results column, you'll see no top fives. He has had one top 10, and Sterling is mired back in 22nd position in the points.
Ricky Rudd losing a couple positions. Dale Jarrett and Rusty Wallace, Jarrett, to come off of turn four. Both of them passed Rudd. And the last lap in here is what he was having. Just moved around Bill Elliott a lap ago, and Kyle Petty continues to move towards the front.
Yes, Kyle Petty running awful well. And they told me in the garage here this morning that Morgan Shepherd in practice yesterday afternoon had the best race car of all, the fastest time, I should say.
Morgan is ninth, Bill is 10th, and Kyle is 11th.
Right on the bottom of the racetrack.
I was going to say, Elliott's up in that upper groove.
That's a characteristic. I don't know if it's a characteristic of Kyle or the race car, but normally that car does its best right on the bottom of the track. That's where he's driving today, and it's working for him. You see, he was racing with Davey Allison a while back when we were on him. He's pulled away from Davey. Davey is the next car in line. Ready back about 15 car lengths.
It's been a nice move toward the 11th position for Kyle. He started 22nd, dropped back to 24th, then moved to 19th at the end of 30 laps, 15th at the end of 50, and with 69 laps completed 2 laps ago, 11th, and now he challenges Bill Elliott for another position.
Bill's not going to fight him too much because Kyle has the line down on the inside. He'll back off going into turn one and let him go.
Well, Junior Johnson held a news conference here yesterday just to answer some questions and especially to put down some rumors that have been flying about concerning his team. The team is not for sale, neither car, and Junior says he hopes because of his recent heart surgery to now be back at almost every race and play a more active role in the Elliott and Hut Strickland cars. Brett Bodine started first, moved up to second, went to third, and leveled off there. And he continues to run in the third position.
And we see the 17 car going by Ricky Rudd. So Rudd, another car that's lost the handle here in the past few laps as Morgan Shepherd gets down on the inside of it.
And John Kernan has more on Darrell Waltrip.
You guys remember Bristol a couple weeks ago? Darrell didn't make the race qualifying, had to use a champion's provisional, started dead last, but finished in the top 10. Now, this is that same race car. Darrell says it just doesn't want to go fast for one or two laps. Barry Dotson told me this morning the car needs 5-plus laps to get its momentum going, and it is set up to run long green flag laps. So watch Darrell Waltrip. He's making his way to the front.
A 10-time winner here at North Wilkesboro. He won his first race in 1977 and his most recent in 1991. Here's his serial. Started 23rd, moved to 15th, 13th, 11th, and now Darrell Waltrip runs in 7th position at the end of
change position here. Terry Labonte has finally gotten on the inside of Brett Bodine coming off of turn 4. They race down the front straightaway side by side, but Labonte has that inside room, but they're coming up on some lap traffic, Bob. Don't know what that'll do for it.
The lap traffic would be Jimmy Means and Ted Musgrave. Down the back stretch, Modine maintains about a half a car length advantage, and now Labonte has to slam on the brakes. You're right, Ned. That lap traffic certainly did play a part.
Sure did. There wasn't anything Labonte could do but just back off. Now he'll have to work and try to get a nose under him once again. He had him passed if he could have just made one more lap.
And Dale Jarrett and Rusty Wallace are also right there with Labonte and Modine. Now here's Labonte again getting to the inside of Brett. The slower car is Ted Musgrave, the U.S. Air Jasper Engines car. Now Labonte is going to be able to take third place away from Modine, I believe. Although it,
I believe he'll have it this time.
He got it.
Yep, he's got it. Now Dale Jarrett try to stick his car up under there as well. Modine quickly covers that inside group.
Here's the way it looks from Rusty Wallace's perspective. He's right behind Dale Jarrett.
We're down in turn one, and you can see that the racetrack, as Ned Jarrett mentioned, a little bit downhill, probably 340 degrees of grade. Now he's going up the back straightaway.
And Dale did take a look to the inside.
And look at Darrell Walker coming up on the outside. He is motoring by all of them. We're trying to. He gets on the outside of Rusty Wallace.
Now he's on the outside of Dale Jarrett.
And Morgan Shepherd trying to come up through there, too. Let's see. Woo! Ted Musgrave saw what was going on, so he just backed out and let him go at it. But this has become some heavy competition.
And Ricky Rudd going back by Rusty Wallace. Well, he's trying to.
And Kyle Petty has caught up to the group.
There's another three abreast shot here, looks to me like.
Here's Waltrip on the outside of Jarrett going into turn three. He has found himself a groove and has that Western Auto Chevrolet on the move.
Shepard is trying it as well.
Darrell has passed Dale Jarrett. A little contact there maybe between Jarrett and Shepard as they work through the third and fourth turns.
Now Darrell Walters up ahead is passing Brett Modine on the inside.
That car can work high or low.
Yeah, just anywhere he wants to go.
Dale Jarrett's on the inside of Modine. Pole sitter and get himself into trouble in the position fast.
Mike Shepherd got a little loose. Morgan takes the spot away from Brett. Here comes Rusty.
And Kyle Petty's joined this group. Brett's going to come down, make some contact, but he held the car.
Great race.
Ricky Rudd goes by Brett Modine.
Brett has fallen several positions here in about the last 10 laps. Well, things have sorted out somewhat, and so we'll take a break and be right back. Here is Dale Earnhardt, and he is about to go a lap down. Jimmy Spencer is also threatening to be lapped by the leader of the race, Sterling Marlin.
Now Spencer and Earnhardt are running in 17th and 18th position. Spencer trying to take over the 17th position. Can't quite make the pass that time. Now he gets the Meineke Ford little burst of power off of turn four and he makes the pass. Sterling Marlin comes down on the inside. Earnhardt goes back out on the outside going into turn one. He's trying to stay in the lead lap.
This is only the second time that Sterling Marlin has led a race in 93. He led one lap at Daytona. Now Earnhardt slips a little bit.
He almost lost control of that car. Oh! And he and the leader make contact coming off turn four.
And it's obvious that Dale Earnhardt is having some handling problems because he wiggled there in turn number two also. Sterling Marlin leaves this race with 90 laps out of 400 completed in the first Union 400. We'll be back in a moment.
There was one thing about Bud that we kept hearing over and over.
Now that's fresh beer.
Huh? Okay, let's say this is the original Budweiser brewery in St. Louis. There's another one in Texas.
And two more in Florida.
New York. California, New Jersey.
Over a dozen of them.
So Budweiser doesn't have to truck their beer clean across the country.
So you know it's fresh.
Right.
Is that my beer in New Jersey?
The best defense is not to offend. Thus, introducing the new RightGuard Sport Stick. Now with a time-release formula for longer-lasting protection against hostile odor all day. For protection that endures.
A hot new peanut just rode into town with a spicy taste that's getting everybody all fired up.
Got some more.
Maybe you ought to practice.
With my new Planters Heat in mild and hot.
Most of our customers come to AutoZone for low prices and for parts they can replace themselves. But many people come because we speak their language. You know, things like duration and lift and compression ratio, stuff like that. Because a guy who's going to rebuild an engine, he won't buy parts from just anybody. And since AutoZone stocks complete engines, we know what makes them tick inside and out. Sure, we sell our best parts at our best prices every day. But if we know something that's going to help you do the job right, you get that free.
ESPN Speed World live at North Wilkesboro Speedway in North Carolina for the first Union 400 that is being led by the Rebestos Ford, driven by Sterling Marlin.
I suppose that car in front of him looks familiar because that was the sponsorship he had last year, Maxwell House, and Earnhardt still tied in that little race car.
He started 21st, moved up, but now is back to 20th. John Kernan is with Richard Childress.
Richard, Dale just went a lap down. Obviously, the car very, very loose. Is that the only problem?
Yeah, we don't know if something's the matter in the rear end or what, but he said it just started jumping loose on him here a few laps ago. Said he can't even touch the gas on the straightaway right now.
Well, they will try and tighten it up at the first chance you guys can get. I know you would love to have a caution to get a pit stop here.
Yeah, we may just go ahead and hit him here. That's what we're talking about right now.
Richard Childress there putting their heads together, talking things over with Andy Beatrice and the rest of the crew. And we may see Dale Earnhardt come into the pits here shortly as a Goodrich crew swings into action.
Dale just got passed by the third place, Darrell Waltrip. Here is Earnhardt, 21st. He moved up to 12th at the end of 20 laps, 11th at 45, and then the slide back began. He moved to 15th, and he now is 20th, one lap down.
Derek Cope's car, the Bojangles Ford, being pushed into the garage area and out of the race as Rusty Wallace goes by to Dale Earnhardt's car. And Dick Trickle, who was involved in that first lap accident, is also back in the race.
Earnhardt's coming in. Drops down to the inside, slams on the brakes, and turns left on the pit road. And Bobby Labonte is also on pit road. Here's John Kernan.
It'll be a four-tire change for the Goodrich crew. Earnhardt comes in. They decided to go ahead and take care of it now. They're coming up on regularly scheduled green flag stops in about 20 to 30 laps. The car just so loose, as you heard Richard Childress tell you, Dale could not drive it. Now the jack goes up through three pumps. They will tighten up the chassis with the left rear. A couple of rounds of wedge. Tires are on. Dale Earnhardt is down and away.
Just past the one-quarter mark. We're on lap 101. Earnhardt making his first pit stop to try to correct a badly handling race car. He's now three laps down. There's the Marlin. And on the racetrack, some good battling. Elliott, Allison, Rudd.
Well, Ricky Rudd was right behind Brett Bodine just a couple of laps ago, and Bill Elliott got on the inside of him. And you can see that Rudd's car just does not go well at all on the outside because he's lost about half a straightaway just in a few laps.
10th, 11th, and 12th there. In the middle is the number 6 car of Mark Martin. He was involved, of course, in that first lap incident, and that car is running well right now.
And he really is running well. One thing that's helping, of course, he has much, much fresher tires than do the others, but as he said, he had an awfully good race car before this race started today, and they probably put it back basically the way it was.
Autolite field summary. The 16 cars on the lead lap.
Never see Earnhardt. He went by the leader with those fresh tires. He went by the leader and Bobby Labonte as well. Those fresh tires are worth. coming. He moves over, and that's Earnhardt Doe.
Gant is 16th and will be the next car to go a lap down if Sterling doesn't pit between now and that time.
Gasoline is not a problem at this speedway. They probably run 150 laps on the tank of fuel, but the tires just get to the point they can't drift the racetrack. All of them have the same problem. Right now, Sterling Marlin's car is the better of the worst.
So we're approaching that time when everybody will have to come in for some fresh rubber. How about it, John Kernan?
Well, you're exactly right. I was talking with Eddie Wood of Wood Brothers, Morgan Shepherd's number 21 set go forward. He was telling me after 20 laps, they only lose about a tenth of a second. But after 20 laps on up, it can drop off as much as a second or more when you get about 60 to 70 laps on these Goodyear Eagles. And so they can, like Benny said, I talked with Barry Dodson, Darrell Walton. He said they can probably go 150, 155 laps. But because of the tires giving up, they see that importance of that with Dale Earnhardt out there. They've got a pit probably in about 20 laps. But what Walter's crew is looking for Sterling Marlin. And when they come in, then Darrell will also pit. Now let's go down to the road to Jerry Punch.
And John, here in the Sterling Marlin pit, they're trying to decide when they pit. They know that when they pit, everyone else will have to pit. And the determining factor here is just what Benny Parsons said. Not fuel mileage, and maybe not even tire wear so much as that stopwatch. Kenny Wilson, the crew chief, standing out on pit road with a stopwatch, clocking every successive lap as Sterling comes by. When those laps start to get slower and slower, Kenny will finally turn and make a determination. Okay, now it's time to pit. Probably the next 15 laps.
So we will await that as Marlin continues to lap slower traffic. Coming up on Rick Wilson at number 44. And that car on the left there is Harry Gant, and he is in 16th position. We're live at North Wilkesboro Speedway in North Carolina for the First Union 400. And we'll be back in just a moment.
Dual Sport 350S. It's a vicious cycle.
At 180 miles an hour, Darrell Waltrip can't afford a bad part.
Ouch! Man, that hurt. Like you, I need quality parts at the right price. And at Western Auto, we guarantee it. You'll find thousands of top-name brand parts, all backed by Western Auto's unbeatable everyday low-price guarantee. Right?
Right, DW. Pick up a Delco Freedom 60 battery at Western Auto for only $49.99. Delco batteries, it's like buying time.
The right parts, unbeatable low prices. At Western Auto, we guarantee it.
Right, DW.
Imagine this is a sidewall of a tire. The whole idea is to keep the tread area in level contact with the road, or you'll lose traction, especially in cornering. Now, Goodyear has learned a lot in NASCAR racing and applied that knowledge to Eagle street radials. In cornering, there's a lot of force trying to lift the tire, but Goodyear Eagle's racing-inspired sidewall design works to hold the tire firmly to the road. Eagle radials, only from Goodyear. We like to say the best tires in the world have Goodyear written all over them.
How far will your money go when buying a Dual Sport 350S? Introducing Suzuki Get On It Flexible Financing. Want to see it again? Other programs include zero down, low monthly payments, and first-time buyer. Get on it.
Back in North Wilkesboro, where Sterling Marlin is about to lap the 16th place car of Harry Gant. Right now, Sterling has a 3.779-second lead on Schrader, 4.5-second lead on Waltrip, 6.76-second lead on Dale Jarrett, and about an 8-second lead on Kyle Petty, who is fifth.
Actually, Morgan Shepherd is in fifth right now, Bob, but Kyle Petty is coming up on him pretty quickly.
Never seen Bobby Hill with those fresh tires. He pitted about 10 laps ago. Just goes blowing right by Ricky Rudd and Brett Bodine. Bud is trying to get by Brett Bodine. This is fourth position. 11th. Rick Wilson's made a pit stop with those fresh tires. He's able to pass his car for the ease.
Darrell Waltrip has moved around Kenny Schrader for second place. Hey, there's a little bit of metal on the
Yeah, front. I thought it was a hot dog wrapper for a while, but no, it is metal.
That's down in turn one, but that's up and out of the racing crew. it's going to be very difficult for the cars to get there to it.
If they get up there, they're in trouble, aren't
they?
Yeah,
big trouble. They're slides when they get there.
Ricky Rudd in 11th position. There's the leader, Marlin.
There goes Darrell Walker by the start-finish line. So about a half straightaway lead that Sterling Marlin has.
I better make it a straightaway, hadn't I?
I think Darrell is gaining on him. I don't think there's any doubt about what Darrell Walker is gaining on Sterling Marlin.
There he goes.
This is a field snapshot. Now watch for your favorite driver to come down. You can see how far he is behind the leader.
And then Dutton turned the clock over. Timing the lap. I'm sorry.
Right.
And remember, they qualified at 19:22. So let's see how fast they're running at this point of the race. 19:22.
21.2.
So they've lost 2 seconds.
The pole sitter, Brett Bodine, is in the pits. He's the only driver eligible for $7,600 in Unical bonus money. Here's Jerry.
And I'm told this is a scheduled pit stop. They were getting slower and slower, so their stopwatch said, hey, we have got to come down pit road and get fresh tires. Both the right side tires haven't gone on. The Quaker stayed forward, and the pole sitting car now has left side tires, cleaning the windshield with the cover to debris to get Richard off the jack. And he spins away 20.7.
Yeah, just a little less than 21 seconds, and Brett Bodine is out on the racetrack once again.
And that's a slow pit stop.
Yeah,
by today's standards, that's a slow pit stop. And a year ago, we'd call that fantastic. Yeah. Here comes Phil Parsons coming in the pits, just out on the right side of our screen.
The Mannheim Auto Auction car.
And there is the Alakowicki racing car being driven by Jimmy Hinsley, almost a lap down to Sterling Marlin.
Here's Phil
making a chassis adjustment on the left rear. Uh-oh, the rear tire. They got to have the jack back around the rear tire.
Morgan Shepherd might have a flat tire. He just went very high in turn two. He has to go forward back down.
They're bringing the jack back around.
Yeah. The right rear, when it was not seated apparently, and not only did it cause that problem, but it also caused some damage there on the sheet metal above the tire. Phil now out after him again.
Well, that's too bad. Cost him a lot of extra time there. As Derek Cope comes back out into Bojangles Ford, he had gone behind the garage into the garage for a while. Morgan Shepherd, I mentioned, went very high. He lost about 3 positions, but he's still out there running.
Marlin now coming up on Jimmy Hinsley. Here is Schrader and Jarrett. This is the battle for position for third. Darrell Waltrip is second, and now Dale Jarrett is looking for third as he comes to the inside of Schrader.
Well, he took advantage of the fact Phil Parsons had those new tires on, and he went on the inside of Schrader, so Jarrett tried to follow him on around there. Schrader's car seems to have gone away a little bit. Of course, all of them are with these worn tires are slipping and sliding a little bit in the turns.
Once again, Jarrett's on the inside, the Interstate Battery Chevrolet.
Ricky Rudd is on pit road in the Tide Chevrolet.
He was just about to go a lap down in 13th, and so he has come in for change of rubber.
We see the fellow around taking the lug nuts off the left side.
About 9 seconds on that side. Now they'll go to the left side of the car.
Walter Smith, he's a jackman on the car, brought it around quickly. Lug nuts being tight. 20.8.
That was just about what Brett's was.
Here's Schrader coming into the pits now. We saw his car slipping and sliding. He began to move back a little bit. He had moved from first back to fourth. And we'll see how the other team can do. Jerry Punch.
And Ken Howe and the Kodiak crew now will go to work on Kenny Schrader's car. Chevrolet, the third place car, they will change right side tires. Just moments ago, you saw the tight crew working on Schrader's teammate's car, Ricky Rudd. And now that was 20.8 seconds halfway up pit road. Let's see if sitting down toward the end of pit road can make a difference with Kenny Schrader. Left side punch up for Rudd. 22.7, a little bit slower, but they have problems with the left rear tire.
There goes Darrell Walter by. Darrell obviously will be the last guy to pit. He always is.
Won't take Schrader long to go back past him, though, with those new tires. Look how that thing sticks down on the inside. Yeah. Boy, that's a great feeling once you get those tires on there. You just smash that accelerator, and away she goes.
You can see the car catch the grip there on the inside of the fourth turn.
Harry Gant also had made a pit stop. Brad Bodine had, so they were just able to go right on around, Darrell, as Sterling Marlin still trying to put a lap on the 7 car, Jimmy Hensley. Here's Kyle Petty apparently hitting for pit road.
He's running in 6th position but has slowed now and makes the entry onto pit road. Mellow yellow Pontiac slides to a stop. John is there.
It'll be a 4-tire change for Kyle Petty. Another one of the drivers complaining about a loose on the race car. John Dotson wearing our crew cam. The work already finished on the right side. They'll put in 2 rounds of wedge on the right rear. Left side's coming off. Robin Kimmerman in his rear. Looks like a pretty good pit stop. And you're making lugs going on. Kyle is down and away. 20.7. Now we're expecting Darrell Waltrip in the pits very, very shortly.
Bill Elliott is in right now. John Kernan is a Budweiser Ford.
So is Wally Dallenbach. Dallenbach actually is going out of the pits while Elliott is in for his pit stop. Davey Allison is pitting at the top of your screen. Now he pulls out. Michael Walter brings the Pennzoil Pontiac to a stop. Dale Earnhardt got another lap back as we watch the action in the pit area, and Elliott pulls out. 35 miles an hour down pit road.
It seems like you're just creeping along when you go at that speed.
There is Earnhardt.
And Sterling Marlin coming into the pits. Marlin coming in.
Also Jimmy Hensley comes in.
Waltrip takes the lead. Jerry Punch is down there where Sterling Marlin is headed right now. Jerry, I'm sure it'll be a 4-tire change.
Well, it'll pretty much have to be. And lap 140, about 10 laps longer than many of us believed they would stay out. The Sterling car is so well healed with this racetrack, they could actually last that long. But with everyone else making pit stops, they couldn't afford to stay out there on used tires and get chewed up by the fresh tires on the other cars. Right side tires already on. Now left side jack goes to make the car. Left front on. Kenny Walter puts the left rear on. They have fueled the car. They wait for the jack. Jack. 22.6. Let's check the Darrell Waltrip pit stop with John Kernan.
Barry Dotson in the crew in the middle of a 4-tire change on Darrell Waltrip. He stayed out, led one lap. Right side's already on, left side's going on. Darrell Waltrip is down and away. 20.8 seconds.
Dale Jarrett and Hut Strickland come in. So does Morgan Shepherd. Jarrett slides to a stop in the Interstate Battery Chevy.
Now, he started to come in a lap before, but he saw Darrell Waltrip coming in. Waltrip, as John Kernan mentioned, had stayed out and led a lap, so Jarrett stayed out there and led a lap as well. A little bit of a chassis adjustment you see there. They're taking, looks like they're taking a little weight off that right rear. So
we can see 22.1.
Here's Kenny Wallace in the Dirt Devil Pontiac. John, it's all yours.
Well, thank you very much, Bob. As we said, 4-tire changes are the order of the day. They've got the right sides going on right now. Kenny Wallace and the crew really had to work very hard yesterday morning because they did not make the race during first-round time trials. They wouldn't have made it, so they had to come back, go to work yesterday morning, and get out there. And Kenny said today he had a pretty good feeling that he would have a good run. Left side is now on. Kenny Wallace is away. 24 seconds.
Rusty Wallace, who was in at the same time that Sterling Marlin was in, and we were watching Sterling, but again, the Miller Genuine Draft Team did a very fine job servicing that car. And the black flag is being shown to, I believe, Jimmy Means as we're inside Rusty's car.
I tell you, Ernie Irvin needs the caution flag, wants the caution flag right now, because remember, he was a couple of laps down. He is now the leader of the race. He's the leader of the race because he has not made his pit stop yet. And there he goes. Kodak Film Chevrolet. The caution flag should come out. He would be right back in the thick of things. But now, he's left to make his pit stop soon and lose a couple of laps.
Irvin involved in one of two crashes that we have had so far. If you're just joining us, we had an accident on the very first lap of the race that involved Ernie Irvin, Jeff Bodine, and Mark Martin, and Jeff Gordon is out of the race also due to a crash. Kyle Petty passing Brett Bodine. Here comes Ernie Irvin in. So he didn't hold the lead very long. Jerry, he's headed toward you.
And our lead car heads down pit road. He is pitting almost all the way out to turn one. Pit road makes a hard left-hand turn at the very end. And now the Kodak film Chevrolet comes to a halt. And Tony Glover and the crew will go to work. Remember, Ernie was involved in that early caution flag. They came down pit road, changed four tires. Now, this will be their second pit stop of the day. The first one, obviously, not a scheduled one. Left side tires going on. It has been fueled. A little trouble with the left rear. Now, lug nuts being faster. Last one.
That was about as good as we saw during that round of pit stops. 21.6 seconds stop for Ernie Irvin.
And here is the leader now, Sterling Marlin.
Look at that. This is good. This documents what you guys tell me and everybody else that's not a race driver, but we don't understand. His lap speed before the pit stop, 103.7. Then his speed after he got the fresh tires moved up to over 111.5 miles an hour. First Union 400 NASCAR Winston Cup race from North Wilkesboro, North Carolina, here on ESPN.
Visit Green Mountain Lincoln Mercury today at the Barry Montpelier Road. Choose from the vast array of beautiful 1993 automobiles for your springtime driving. See the 1993 Grand Marquis with a 3-year or 36,000-mile bumper-to-bumper warranty. Choose between a $1,500 cash rebate or 3.9% financing for 48 months. And check out their complete state-of-the-art service department. Take Exit 7 from Interstate 89, follow the signs to Montpelier, turn right at the bottom of the hill. Green Mountain Lincoln Mercury, number one in customer satisfaction.
We want to take you for a ride.
It's fun. It's challenging. It's Tour de Cure, a day of cycling to raise funds to help find an answer to diabetes. Ride for fitness or fun. Choose your own pace, novice or expert. You'll have a great time, and the cure could be riding on you. Sign up for Tour de Cure or sponsor a rider. Call your local American Diabetes Association office today.
ESPN, top-ranked boxing. Mayweather battles Padilla. Former two-time world champion Roger Mayweather must win if he wants a shot at his third world championship. He faces the very dangerous and unpredictable Zach Padilla. Top-ranked boxing, Saturday night at midnight Eastern, live on ESPN.
We're back at North Wilkesboro Speedway in North Carolina, and all of us here in the broadcast booth and the producers and the director would like to congratulate the ESPN technical team for their excellent work that has resulted in an Emmy Award. The competition was stiff, the Indianapolis 500, the Olympics, but our guys walked off with the most prized possession of all, the Emmy.
Yeah, guys.
How about that? They also beat the America's Cup. Or the America's Cup team was also a winner in that competition.
And there's going to be a competition just... It's already a competition. Darrell Waltrip and Kenny Schrader.
Schrader is just about a second behind Sterling. Darrell is 1.3. Rusty Wallace is 2 seconds behind. And Kyle Petty is about 4.5 seconds behind Sterling Marlin.
And Darrell Waltrip has closed up the gap, and there he goes on the outside of Kenny Schrader. Then he keeps making that pass on the outside.
Well, he does. That car is working great today.
He started 23rd.
Now moves into second.
During the commercial break, I watched the cars going off turn four, and his car looks better to me than any of those cars getting off that corner.
It is hooked up, as we say in racing. And what we mean by that is that when he mashes the accelerator coming off the turn, that he's able to get traction.
Here's Rusty Wallace.
Rusty's car is running better now than he did before he made the pit stop.
Here's a Fram field summary. This is the way they were running last lap. Brett Bodine, the pole sitter, is 7th. Dale Earnhardt started 21st, now running 15th. There are 16 cars that are on the lead lap. Jimmy Hensley is the last car on the lead lap.
See, there are the cars that are laps down. See, Rusty now trying to make a pass on Kenny Schrader. And I've noticed him today, Benny, that he has been very careful when he makes these passes, as he is right now. A couple of cars have passed him early in the race, and he didn't fight them too much. Is that championship thinking?
Well, certainly it is, but the pit crew, they have put their heart and soul into this. They're making great pit stops. They're giving him track position on the racetrack. Now, he's not going to do anything stupid, go out there and tear up that race car. Because they're doing it for him, he's going to win.
That's maturity. That's teamwork.
I think there is an element of that, though, Ned. You know, you can ask anybody before the race, is the championship most important or is the race? And they'll say, well, if we win the race, obviously we're going to come out with the most points. But when they get into the race and find out everything that's going on, they have a tendency, I think, to settle for something less than a win just to maintain a good point. Now there is Hensley, who is, as we indicated, the last car on the lead lap. So Sterling is coming up to try to put a lap on Jimmy Hensley.
And there's Earnhardt. Remember how fast he was going with the fresh tires. Now these cars have tires fresher than his, and he's not able to compete with them. He simply moves over and they go by. And again, that's maturity on Dale Earnhardt's place, because used to he would have raced them.
Yep.
But now he realizes he can't race them. He doesn't have a horse to race right now.
Oh,
and he's
Earnhardt
coming in the pits.
Yeah. This is a bumper cam on Hensley's car. You saw Dale Earnhardt flank off and come in for another stop. John, he's all yours.
Well, it's only 63 laps this time, but like you pointed out, the car continues to spin the tires off the corner. So Andy Dietrich has told them to come on in. They are going to add wedge, and they add a couple rounds right there in the left rear. Right sides are already on, left sides coming off. New Stickers Junior Racing Eagles going on. A slow pit stop for Dale Earnhardt, 24 seconds. And you know, any time you make a chassis adjustment, that costs you in seconds on the pit road, guys.
And John, they made a chassis adjustment on the right front. They reached in and turned the bolt on the right front to adjust the chassis, and it got David Smith coordination. The jack man added coordination. He dropped the jack and had to jack the car back up. So they had a little bit of confusion that time in the Earnhardt pit.
Look who is sneaking up on the leader, gentlemen. It is Darrell Waltrip.
Oh, DW, huh?
He is really closing in. And Rusty Wallace is too.
Yep, he's coming right along. Kyle Petty is not too far behind, although Kyle is in fifth, but he is gaining on the leader. Kenny Schrader is in the fourth position right now.
And that seventh car there for the last 15, 20 laps.
And battling for position, Davey Allison and Dale Jarrett. This is for sixth.
We saw him make that chassis adjustment on Jarrett's car. I don't think that it's working too well for him.
Davey Allison has had a good race so far, starting 27th to 12th, 10th, 19th, and now he is up to 7th at the end of 170 circuits.
I tell you what, when I talked to Davey this morning, I sure wouldn't believe he'd been up to 7th. He was talking like a 20th place car.
Really?
And he makes the pass.
Yep. Allison is the defending champion of that race. There is Sterling Marlin, who continues to set the pace in the Revestis Ford for Bobby Allison. We're live at North Wilkesboro Speedway in North Carolina. Ned, Benny, John, Jerry, and I will be back after this.
Today's history lesson, the fork.
No! I'm talking front fork! Look!
Since day one, it's done two jobs, steering and suspension.
You ever tried holding down two jobs?
Now, cut to the new Yamaha GTS 1008.
The Sultan of Swing Arms.
One arm steers, one does suspension. No fork, no fuss. Yamaha doesn't just make motorcycles, they make history. End of lesson.
Over a million people each week walk into AutoZone, and taking care of them means having what they need when they need it. That means stocking a lot of parts for a lot of cars. Now, nobody can stock everything, but we stock more than most. And how do we know which ones to carry? That's easy. We listen to our customers, because nobody knows better about what you want than you. So the next time you walk through that door, you might think of yourself as a customer, but we think of you as the boss.
For those who like to spend lots of time and effort cleaning, shining, and protecting your tires, this is going to be difficult to watch. Because with no-touch tire care, you don't need to rub or wipe your tires to make them look great. It's true. You just spray it on and leave it alone. No touching. Now, we know it's hard, but you've got to fight it. Come on, you can do it. That's good. No-touch tire care. The best touch is no touch.
No, I'm not a fighter. You only fight when you have to. See, this game is not about fighting. It's about competing, playing hard. I think we tend to get out of what it's all about, what the league is all about. You know, it's not about who's going to outpound who.
177 laps completed here at North Wilkesboro, and there are the top five, and it separates each of them. Marlin, Waltrip, Wallace, Schrader, and Petty, 1-5, separated by a little more than 3 seconds. Sun-baked crowd enjoying the racing here at North Wilkesboro on this beautiful Sunday afternoon. You must have misunderstood me, Benny. I did not say Bobby Allison.
I heard the Stavola brothers,
but they sound so much alike. Stavola brothers.
And Bobby Allison.
Exactly right. Oh, yeah. Yeah.
You just misunderstood. I hope I'm making a mistake. There's the interval between first and second and third.
Yeah. The seven car is Jimmy Hensley.
He's still staying on the lead lap.
Still staying on the lead lap. He's been there for quite a while. Here's our bumper cam as he looks back at Carolyn Marlin's Ford. But when Carolyn Marlin pitted, Jimmy Hensley pitted, they've been racing together ever since. And here's Darrell on the outside. Whoop. I thought it was closer than it was.
Yeah,
got me excited.
And you got me excited.
Yeah.
Now Darrell does look to the outside.
I'd almost bet that he makes his pass on the outside.
Jarrett and Shepard are running together along with Bobby Labonte.
Shepard just moved around, Jarrett, for the seventh position.
Now Jimmy Hensley goes a lap down. He stayed on the lead lap for 182 circuits. Here's Waltrip now doing likewise. Third place is Wallace on the right.
Jimmy Hensley running 14th. There again, right in front. He just was left, and he's coming into the 10th.
Yep.
Yeah, he was in 13th position.
Lost the lap and immediately came in for fresh tires.
There he is. The Skull Bandit slides to a stop. Goes to work on the right side.
See him in there, they're making a chassis adjustment on that car in the right front.
Takes a little extra time when you do it on the right front, but that spring is so much stronger than any other spring on the car, so when you make an adjustment there, it has more effect.
Harry going two laps down, but he's back out there. Has never won a NASCAR Winston Cup race. And here is Dale Earnhardt, who's on fresh tires, and Ricky Rudd. Earnhardt is running 20th, two laps down, and Rudd is 10th on the lead lap. Now here is Waltrip and Wallace. Wallace is caught. Darrell.
Sterling is pulled away. Darrell was right on there a little bit ago, but now he's got his hands full from the guy behind.
Looks like Jimmy Hensley might have been holding up Sterling Marlin just a little bit.
But once he moved around, he has taken off.
Yeah.
Second, third, Walter Wallace. Rusty won the fall race here in 1988. Darrell has won this event four times in the fall race on different occasions.
There, Darrell goes up the hill. Rush is going to try to get alongside of him. Can't quite make it. That's all Rush is waiting for, is Darrell to go in the corner just a little bit too hard so he can get underneath him.
Davey Allison had an excellent pit stop last time, and look what it did for him on the racetrack. And this, again, is something that Ned and Benny 17.2 second stop, and this is what it did for him on the track. He picked up four positions because of that.
Well, it gave him a chance to win the race. If he had lost 4 seconds, he went from 10th back to 14th, then he'd be a lot down.
They do have that Ford working much better now than earlier in the race.
There we can see how the race relationship between Davey and Darrell Walter. This is a race for second. Darrell, the 17, is in second. The two, black two, Rusty Wallace, is in third.
And Marlin is in heavy traffic. Dahlin back and Brett Bodine ahead, and the pole sitter is about to go a lap down.
He is currently running in the 12th position, Brett Bodine, in the Quaker State Ford.
And he does go a lap down. Now Bobby Hillen is out there in the blue car. He will lose another lap. Hillen being shown in 25th spot. And Jerry Punch is down in the garage area with a comment on Jeff Gordon, who crashed out early.
Well, Bob, Ray Everham and the DuPont crew were back there trying to put the car together. But if you look at the lap count, as we put lap 193 on the scoreboard, we're just 7 laps away from halfway. If you do some quick math, you realize that if they were to get this car fixed, as they're putting the fuel cell in right now, they still probably would not be able to pick up an extra spot in the field, so they're almost 200 laps down. So why try and take a chance on tearing up the car, possibly injuring your driver with a battered race car? So they're going to call it a day back here in the garage.
And so unofficially, Jeff Gordon will finish in last position, and a tough break for the young rookie who is battling with Bobby Labonte and Kenny Wallace for Rookie of the Year standings in 1993. Sterling Marlin battling his first Winston Cup win here at North Wilkesboro. He's the leader near the halfway mark.
Burt Reynolds talks with the Quaker State team.
Hold on. I gotta get my name on the car. My fans are getting restless.
No room.
How about on the big Q?
The big Q stands alone. Stands for quality.
You can't get better protection.
No other oil beats Quaker State.
How about right here?
No way. Red doesn't like to be crowded.
My fans are getting demanding.
All right. We'll go get the painter.
I must have had a hard time finding the painter. Nothing beats Quaker State. It's one tough motor oil.
When it's this hot outside, you know how hot it is inside. That's why you need Armorall, the world's leading protectant. No matter how hot it gets or how cold, Armorall helps keep your dash looking new. We're so sure about it, we guarantee it. If your new dash ever cracks, we'll replace it. Guaranteed. There is a fountain of youth, and we guarantee it. Armorall. Don't take chances.
From the days when they ripped through the sands of Daytona to tracks like Talladega and Darlington, racing fans have had a love affair with the drivers. To commemorate these heroes, Country Time presents our new collector series featuring Kulwicki, Gant, Shepard, Hamilton, Jarrett, and Darrell Waltrip. What better way to salute the men who risk it all on the speedway and the fans who make it all worthwhile?
This is where America gets together. Every weekend throughout America, there is great NASCAR racing.
I wouldn't be anywhere else.
At North Wilkesboro is for second place. Sterling Marlin leads. Here's the battle for second. Darrell Waltrip and Rusty Wallace.
I thought Rusty was going to pass him, but Darrell put together a pretty good lap there.
Yeah, and he's running a little bit higher line than Rusty is, but getting good traction off the turns. I'm sure that Rusty thought he had him too, but here is a pass for fourth position?
Fifth
position.
Yep.
So maybe Allison was in sixth and trying to move around Kenny Schrader. Like he's got it done.
Yes, he does. Takes a spot away. Here comes Morgan Shepherd up to challenge Schrader.
Remember Davey Allison a year ago when he came to this racetrack with broken ribs and some broken vertebrae after a crash at Bristol? He won the thing.
Yep. Jimmy Hinton stood by in his pits all day just in case Davey couldn't make it, but he did make it all the way to Victor Circle. Morgan Shepherd on the inside of Schrader. This is for sixth. Ooh, and Morgan gets a little bit sideways and saves her.
Rick was just in the pits a couple laps ago, so he has fresh tires on. He'll go right on past him.
He is in 21st position, three laps down. Rick Mast in his 100th NASCAR Winston Cup starts. There's Sterling, the leader. Second position, the 17 of Darrell Waltrip. There he is behind Jimmy Spencer. Waltrip, remember at Bristol, how he came from 35th and finished 6th? He has the most top five finishes here in North Wilkesboro, 18 in 37 starts. That's a percentage of 49% for Darrell Waltrip.
I tell you what, Sterling Marlin has really impressed me today.
Yeah, me too.
Those guys have really got their... They've never won a race. That eight car, I mean, the eight car has won a race, but Sterling Marlin has never won a race. There's Kyle Petty.
And he's come from 22nd to 4th, so he had nothing to sneeze about either.
And everybody thought that when Sterling Marlin won his first was while he was driving for Junior Johnson, and maybe it would come here at North Wilkesboro, but it didn't.
Maybe it'll come from North Wilkesboro with the Stavola brothers.
Mellow yellow Pontiac. By the way, I saw Kyle's owner, Felix Sabatis, down in the garage area before the race. He introduced me to the president of Nintendo, and we're trying to put a deal together to have Nintendo to sponsor the 7 car out in Sears Point. You know, Bojangles is going to sponsor the next three races.
Here's Bobby Hillen, who's come in for a stop.
And no, he's not, that's not illegal or whatever. That's the only way he can get to his pits, because he's so far up towards turn 4.
I think his is the very first pit, isn't it?
No, there's another one. Is there 16 car Wally Dallenbach?
Oh, yeah.
Has to pit behind him.
Yep.
And Jimmy Beans. Wally Dallenbach and Jimmy Beans are using the same.
Sharing, right. Yep.
There simply were not enough pits here when they increased the field this year to 32 plus two provisionals, so there were 34 cars started the race today.
Hiling Myers Ford in 26th position for Bobby Hillen. Marlin coming up now on the 11th place car of Bill Elliott. And now our Western Auto race summary. Sterling Marlin has led 146 of the first 205 laps. There we have 11 cars on the lead lap. 7 leaders, 7 changes, 2 cautions, and the average speed so far is 86.6 miles an hour. Those that have led a lap and picked up the 5 bonus points include Marlon Schrader, Brett Bodine, Ernie Irvin, Dale Jarrett, Kenny Wallace, and Darrell Waltrip, as Brett Bodine, you can see, is in the pit area. Jeff Gordon is the only car officially out of the because of a fiery crash up in turn number 1. Jeff was okay. Now our Western Auto Mechanic of the Year standings. Andy Petrie is on top with 415 points. Buddy Parrott is second, then Steve Meehl and Johnny Wingo. And this battle for second place continues here as Rusty has been following Darrell Waltrip for the last several laps, but has not been able to get around him.
I thought he had him that time, but maybe this time, maybe this time. Darrell's going up. Rusty's going to pull alongside of him right there. Now Rusty's going to get on the gas and come up the back straightaway and pass Darrell Waltrip.
He's got it. Once he got up there, he said, okay, that's enough. Now, here's Brett Bodine. He just came
watch
out.
This. Yes,
watch him.
Darrell's dropping back significantly, it looks like.
Well, he had to back off the gas there and let Brett go, so.
Junior Johnson used to own this racetrack. It hasn't been that way in recent years, and now Bill Elliott, one of his drivers, is about to go a lap down to Sterling. Elliott is in 11th position.
Well, look at Kyle. He has caught Darrell Waltrip and is trying to
come
third.
Where did he come from?
Yeah, he's been gradually gaining all along, just slipping right up on him. There's Bobby Hillen with those new tires, so he'll pass both of them.
So Kyle is now third, and Darrell is fourth. Handling the tires must have gone away on Darrell because he's dropped from second to fourth here in the last two laps. Our pit reporters will check on that, and we'll have a report for you in just a moment. Sterling Marlin from Columbia, Tennessee, continues to lead the First Union 400.
At 180 miles an hour, Darrell Waltrip can't afford a bad part.
Ouch! Man, that hurt. Like you, I need quality parts at the right price. And at Western Auto, we guarantee it. You'll find thousands of top name brand parts, all backed by Western Auto's unbeatable everyday low price guarantee. Right?
Right, DW. Pick up a Delco Freedom 60 battery, Western Auto, for only $49.99. Delco batteries, it's like buying time.
The right parts, unbeatable low prices. At Western Auto, we guarantee it.
Right, DW.
Oil. It's the lifeblood of your engine. That makes your oil filter your engine's most vital organ. That's why Fran keeps going the extra mile to make the best protection even better. The Fran Extra Guard Oil Filter. Unique glass fiber paper stops more dirt than any other filter for the best protection ever. Fran Extra Guard. American or import, it's an extra lease on life. Deodorant that keeps a man feeling as clean and fresh as this. All through the... Well, this is it. Introducing New Band for Men. Clean and fresh because it goes on clear. And New Band for Men sets up a clear shield of protection that fights odor-causing bacteria for a full 24 hours. Feel this clean. Feel this fresh. Try New Clear Band for Men deodorant.
Major League excitement.
5 nights a week.
On ESPN.
This week on America's Game of the Week, Andy Van Slyke leads the Pirates against Daryl Strawberry and the Dodgers. Tonight, live on ESPN Sunday Night Baseball. Does this man look familiar? Probably not, but he's a very important person in the history of NASCAR Winston Cup racing. He was the very first winner of what is now NASCAR Winston Cup competition, June 19th of 1949. Jim Roper, who's the Grand Marshal of today's race here at North Wilkesboro. He's now 76 years old and races thoroughbred horses in Kauffman, Texas.
You know, I saw that first race. I was about 16
really?
Years old. It was at Charlotte after the track that's no longer in existence, 3/4 mile dirt track.
Huh.
And I was standing right down. I was so excited about what was going on down there, and they had the wooden post holding up a hog wire type fence, and I was standing right down next to the track. I wanted to feel those cars go by. And I leaned against one of those posts, and a fan blade came off of one of them and stuck
Whoa.
Right to that post that I was leaning against.
Oh, my God. You're watching Sterling Marlin, the leader of this race. Did you know at that time that you wanted to do that someday?
Well, I was very, very interested in auto racing. I didn't know if I'd ever get an opportunity to do it, but I knew that I wanted to.
Well, Darrell Waltrip has passed Kyle Petty, taking position back, but now Kyle comes, and here is Ken Schrader making it 3 abreast. Ken has fresh tires.
Yeah, he just made a pit stop a couple of laps ago, so he has that traction down on the inside. So that sort of fouled up Kyle's strategy there, didn't it?
How about it, John Kernan?
Just talking with Barry Dodson, Darrell Waltrip's crew chief. He says the car is just a little bit tight right now. They'll be making their scheduled pit stop in about 50 laps or so. They'll loosen it up just a little bit, but he doesn't seem to be too concerned about the car being tight right now.
Darrell still hanging on to the position. He is in third, Kyle's fourth. This spot belongs to Morgan Shepherd.
Morgan Shepherd, actually, now that, yeah, that's right. And, fifth place, Davey Allison has moved back to sixth as Morgan got around him.
Now see this eighth car, he's leading the race. Sterling Marlin, the car, Rusty Wallace running second. There's Rusty. And guys, we're going to see some pit stops pretty soon. The 8 car knows the pressure is on. Don't you know that crew realizes the pressure is on? They've got to make a pit stop as good as that 2 crew. Man, don't you know that they got some butterflies in their stomach right now.
And there's Ricky Rudd just came out of the pit. Look at him just shoot by Man. Kyle Petty.
And shoots by Darrell Waltrip.
Boy, those new tires just make such a difference. Well, we pointed out there a little while ago, there's a lot of miles per hour difference.
So 8 miles an hour difference between a lap just before a pit stop and a lap just after a pit stop.
And this continues to be the best battle on the track by far, as Petty and Waltrip are trading positions just about every lap or every other lap. And now Harry Gant sticks his nose in here.
Well, Harry was in, he's
been out there 25 or so laps since he made his pit stop. We saw him come in once he went a lap down, but his tires are still much, much fresher than these two.
Harry is 15th, two laps down.
Now Darrell's going to try to pass Kyle back again. Wouldn't that be something?
Well, they've given the fans something to root for here because they have had a good battle going on.
We saw Kyle Petty's car, the rear end on his car, wiggle just a tick as he came off that second corner. So that means that a little bit loose.
Kyle trying to keep the string intact. He has four straight top 10 finishes through last week at Bristol. Now, here's the on-track interval showing how Rusty Wallace has closed in on the leader, Sterling Marlin. Laps 224 through 228. The interval was reduced from 2.6 seconds to 2 seconds even.
Now, some of that was because Sterling was in some traffic. Now, Rusty has to go through that same traffic, including Bill Elliott, who did go a lap down. So now there are only about eight cars in the lead lap as a result of Schrader and Rudd having made pit stops.
There's Sterling with Rick Wilson, who apparently has also come in for some fresh tires because he passes Sterling with these.
Apparently easy to tell, can't you?
Yeah.
My hat's off to Sterling. I've said it before, but you know, his car has been running well, but we haven't seen anything this year that would say that he was going to go out and just dominate this race as he has today.
His best finish so far this year was a ninth at Daytona.
But Ricky Rudd goes by with those pressure tires, and we can see right behind him, Rusty Wallace. And if we can see him back there, you know that Sterling Marlin can see him.
Yeah, he's closing in, nothing but daylight between them now.
236 laps completed. We're riding with Rusty.
And you know Rusty Wallace now can see the 8 car, and that gives you more, gets the adrenaline going just a tick more to drive a little bit deeper, get on the gas just a little bit harder to catch that guy in front of you. Sterling going by the Wally Dollenbach car, the Keystone Deer car.
Jimmy Spencer and Bobby Hamilton in the pit. Hamilton going out of the pit, so Jimmy Spencer coming in for a change of tires on the line of the muffler car.
Wallace continues to pursue the leader, Sterling Marlin, here at North Wilkesboro. We're glad you could be with us on this Sunday afternoon, and we'll be back with more live coverage in a moment.
When you think Chevrolet, Oldsmobile, Nissan, and Geo, think Handy of St. Albans. Our new car and truck lot is outstanding with an over 125-unit inventory at all times. And we continually carry over 100 used vehicles as well. You'll be treated by our professional sales and service staff with no pressure, no hype, just good, solid deals. Handy Chevy Olds Nissan Geo, easy to get to, easy to deal with, is located at the end of the ramp off exit 20 on I-89.
It's time to gear up for fishing season, and your complete fishing outfitters is Knight Sports Center in Essex Junction. Knight's has a complete fly fishing department where you'll find Sage Graphite, Loomis, IMX, and Cortland fly rods, fly tying materials, plus waders, vests, and rain gear. For lake fishing, Knight's has an outstanding selection of lures and spoons, downriggers by Big John, and electronics by Eagle and Lawrence. Knight's carries rods and reels by Shimano, Daiwa, and St. Croix, plus all the lures and terminal tackle you'll ever need. Knight's Sports Center for all your fishing needs, Pearl Street, Essex Junction.
All the excitement of great high school players, they're going to be getting down, slam dunks, passing. I'm going to have a ball because I'm going to be coaching. The Magic Round Ball Classic, yeah.
Wilkes County, North Carolina, steeped in history. When you visit North Wilkesboro Speedway, there are a lot of other sites to visit. And here's one of them. The Wilkes County Courthouse in Wilkesboro was built back in 1902, and an example of official classical revival structure built at the turn of the century. That is a gorgeous building, isn't it?
Oh,
obviously
beautiful.
Well kept, and this lawn well manicured. That is
one of the most historic things about Wilkes County is the birthplace of
Benny Parsons.
Yeah. And I'll tell you what, looks like it's going to be a great finish today because Wallace is there.
Yeah, he's caught. He's caught Sterling Marlin.
Uh-oh, he got bumped.
Yeah, he did.
He got bumped a little bit by the 52 car of Jimmy Means, I believe.
Rusty, two or three car lengths. Rusty Wallace has five top fives in the last five races, and that equals the number of top fives that he had in all of 1992.
Is that right?
Yep.
Man, that is interesting.
Here it is.
He has really been on a roll.
Well, pit stops are going to be coming up before long. Jerry, what have you learned about strategy?
Bob, we checked in with both of the top two crews. Buddy Parrott, the crew chief for Rusty Wallace, says if we can just go past the lap 260 mark, which is about 12 laps away, we can make it on fuel and not worry about it. So they're going to at least stay out another 12, probably another 20 laps, because the 8 car of Sterling Marlin is probably going to come in around lap 275. Their first pit stop was at lap 140. 135 laps later, which will be 275, should be their second and probably final scheduled stop of the day. Let's go up pit road to John Kernan.
Jerry, that's exactly what they're talking about right up here. In fact, you've got Kyle Petty's crew wanting to come out. And Rusty Wallace has just moved into the lead as he goes around Sterling Marlin. Darrell Waltrip, we're expecting him about lap 270. Kyle Petty about lap 270. But Davey Allison, Larry McGriddle say they will pit about 10 laps earlier. They're running in sixth place right now. And they had a 17-second pit stop on their first effort. So look for them. We know about the 10 laps, guys.
Rusty Wallace started ninth, moved quickly to third, stayed there for a while, moved to second, and at about 31 laps has moved into first position. Rusty Wallace is the leader. They're looking at Jimmy Spencer go around him.
Well, we said he was in the pits not long ago, so was Derek Pope from the 98 car. So with those fresh tires, here they go. Sterling's car has sort of gone away.
Bobby Hamilton, the country time Ford, made a pit stop. He goes by the leader.
He was one of those involved in the first lap accident, has some damage on the right side of his car. So it's now Rusty Wallace in command of the first Union 400 with a little less than 150 laps to go.
On earth that I'd rather be out in the open where it's all plain to see. If it's gonna get done, it's up to you and me. Come on and head for the mountains of bush. Come on and head for the mountains of bush.
Beer.
Why use Valvoline motor oil? It's the number one choice of Indy 500 chief mechanics. Daytona 500 chief mechanics. NHRA mechanics. And Baja 1000 mechanics. For use in their race cars and in their own cars. Any more questions? People who know use Valvoline.
Thank you. Pull around.
Thank you.
Paul Coughlin, call the Big L 93. In the next 93 seconds, you'll be today's big winner.
I need a phone.
Hello, where are you, Paul?
I'm coming.
Because what you want is lunch in minutes. Our crew really hustles for you. So now, what you want is what you get at McDonald's today.
Paul, you still have 24 seconds. Call, babe.
This will take a minute.
Hey, Paul, you out there, buddy? Bob Jenkins, Ned Jarrett, Benny Parsons, John Kernan, and Dr. Jerry Punch with you at North Wilkesboro, North Carolina Speedway for the seventh event of the 92 NASCAR Winston Cup season, the first Union 400, and we show you a Fram Field summary where everyone was running last lap. The leader is the number two Miller Genuine Draft Pontiac driven by Rusty Wallace.
And Ned, I tell you what, the eight car strategy is going right out the window because Rusty Wallace is driving away. Well, the A car needs to get in and get tires as quickly as he can, don't you think?
Well, yes, but he can't afford to come in now, Benny. If this thing goes green the rest of the way with 140 laps to go, he's going to be sitting there in bad shape with tires at the end of the race. So he needs to go so he can maybe have 125, 130 laps to go on that last set of tires.
The A car needs to beat the two car in the pit.
How'd you like to have that task in front of us?
A couple of guys have come in for pit stops. Dick Trickle, Hut Strickland, both on pit road. Ted Musgrave moves out. There's Jimmy Hensley in the number 7 car.
The Bojangles Ford and Kenny Schrader, the Kodiak Chevrolet, both of them go by Sterling. There's our leader, Rusty Wallace, the black number 2. Ted Musgrave, the Jasper Engine U.S. Air Force, right behind.
Ted just came out of the pit, so he'll motor right on around. Rusty.
Junior Johnson's Bill Elliott car now in the pits. Hut Strickland made a stop. In fact, he's just pulling out of the pits as Elliott comes in.
Elliott was running in the 9th position before he came in, I believe. He had gone a lap down.
Bill patiently waiting for the crew to go to the left side of the car and begin the work over there on the racetrack. Schrader unlaps himself. Harry Gant passes the leader, Rusty. Bill Elliott is out of the pits.
Now Elliott will be able to catch Rusty in a moment and just drive by him with those fresh tires.
There's second place. Marlin, boy, traffic jam here, huh?
Boy, I'd say the traffic is horrible. I think Sterling's kind of playing it smart, just going on the inside and letting these cars go, yeah. Because Rusty tried to race him a little bit, and here's Davey Allison in the pit.
John Kernan is there.
It'll be a 4-tire change. Of course, Davey can't go the rest of the distance. He's sitting about 5 laps later than what Larry McReynolds had told me. Right sides are already on. Left side's going on. They had a 17.1-second stop on their last effort. Left side now going on. Joey Knuckles got this thing. Go, go, go. 19 seconds now. One note I want to make. Nick Rainey is sitting in here with a camcorder, and he is taping the pit stop so they can take it back and analyze it. Now let's go to Jerry Punch.
And Sterling Marlin's crew could wait no longer. The Revestas Ford getting slower and slower on used tires. They had to come in now and roll the dice. Rusty Wallace, meanwhile, will come down and get his service. Left side tires going on the Revestas Ford as he is out and away. 20.1 seconds. Now let's look at our leader, Rusty Wallace, as his effort continues up pit road. The Miller Genuine Draft crew, remember in Bristol, Tennessee, 16.1 seconds. The key, the right front tire man, Phil Wilbert. 18 seconds off, Rusty Wallace is down pit road.
Good stop for Rusty. Terry Labonte came in just ahead of him in the pit stall, directly ahead of him, and I thought there may be a problem getting out, but not. Here's John Kernan with Kyle's pit stop.
They're already changing left side tires right now. They've made a chassis adjustment, tightening up the car. Kyle staying in very loose. He runs the car and is away. Darrell Waltrip has also pulled on pit road. It will be another 4-tire change. We told you about 50 laps ago. The car was tight. Well, about 15 laps ago, he radioed in and told Barry Dodson it had gotten very, very loose. So they will tighten it up with one round of wedge on the right rear. Left side now going on. They're going to cut away a piece of tape from the front of the driller. And now Darrell Walker is headed down pit road.
It was Dale Jarrett, and he had a pretty good pit stop, didn't he, Nick?
Yeah, he had a good pit stop. It's about 20 and a half seconds, and they reversed that chassis adjustment that they made the time before, which had him almost a lap down. So,
well, with all the pit stops being made, Morgan Shepherd has moved to the front. Or has he? Or is it Schrader? Or is it Waltrip?
Schrader right now.
Is it? Yeah. In fact, no, Schrader had made a pit stop very early. Came out past the leader, went all the way around the racetrack and passed him again. He had got back in the lead lap and green flag running. Now, he will probably have to make another pit stop, but that car is going to be awfully fast. So, I don't know. He might have the right strategy, making an extra pit stop. But if precaution should come out now, you know, he'd be right back with everybody else. Come out in the next 29 when he pits, he'd be right back with everybody else.
or he might be able to make that extra pit stop and still come back up.
Schrader shown as the leader, second place, Ricky Rudd, third, Rusty Wallace, fourth, Sterling Marlin, and fifth, Davey Allison at the end of 275 laps. Back with more live action from North Wilkesboro in just a moment.
Revestis has the right brake for you. No matter what car you drive. Revestis, the best in brakes. For the nearest Revestis parts store or installer, call 1-800-4-REVESTIS.
Noble warrior advised, the art of protection springs from within. One must stay vigilant against one's unfragrant perspiration, lest one provoke a hostile response. Thus, a Norse ritual is Rightguard Sports Stick. An aromatic array of the freshest scents and maximum protection against disarming wetness.
Confirming the wisdom, the best defense is not to offend.
Rightguard Sports Stick. Anything less would be uncivilized.
Ken Schrader, First Union 400 here in North Wilkesboro, North Carolina. Dale Earnhardt is in for a pit stop. Gene Goodrich team going to the right side, and Charles Kernan is there.
You know, earlier this year, Dale Earnhardt and company were fighting a tight-handling race car. Now they've been fighting a loose-handling race car here today. Will be another four-tire change for the Andy Petrie and the crew. Left side's going on. Dale Earnhardt comes the engine and headed down pit road, 20.9 seconds.
Now he's definitely, if this thing stays green, going to make one more pit stop at least than most of the other front runners at least.
Yeah,
as he stopped earlier.
There's 120 laps to go, and I don't think they're going to run 120 laps without stopping again.
And he's already made an extra pit stop. Yeah.
Dale Jarrett has moved up into
He just moved around eight car. He is a lap down right now to Rusty Wallace, but Sterling Marlin is running second, and Jarrett just moved around him.
And look at Davey Allison.
Yep.
He's made a good pit stop. Plus, Sterling Marlin's running. He's passing on the racetrack after his pit stop. It doesn't seem to be running as well as it did before the pit stop, because Rusty Wallace has increased his lead, and now Davey Allison has caught Sterling Marlin.
Well, I said that Sterling was second. That's not true. He is actually in fourth place. Kenny Schrader is leading this race, and Ricky Rudd is in second. But they're out of sync with the others as far as pit stops are concerned. Rusty right now is coming up on, as we see, Darrell Walker trying to move around Ken Schrader and get back in the lead lap. And Rusty is coming up on Ricky Rudd, which would be a position for him as Walker does get back in the lead lap.
And just with five parlays on Schrader in no time. Here we see we're inside Rusty Wallace's car as he drives up behind Ricky Rudd, as Ned mentioned. And there it is, we can see. He's going to go on the inside, just turns it left and drives by.
Easy. Well, here's a Napa field summary. Schrader, Rudd, Wallace, Marlin, and Allison are your top five, and there are nine cars on the lead lap. Brett Bodine sat on the pole, is running 10th a lap down.
No contact at all hardly with Rusty Wallace today.
No, it's unscathed. Well, Jerry Punch has a report from the pit area. Jerry?
Well, you've seen it in college football, in the NFL.
watching film is very critical to making a team change that may improve your performance. We're right here in the Joe Gibbs pits. We're going to see a film or a camera, but right here on top of their pit box. Dale Jarrett's team, they film every single pit stop. They go back to the shop, and now they're going to watch, see how they can improve. This little camera here may be one of the most critical pieces of pit equipment in Winston Cup racing here on the short track.
Well, you do everything to make the car run better and to make yourself work a little harder, more efficiently. Allison and Marlin are running together again.
That's fourth position. Marlin has the fourth position. Davey Allison trying to take it away.
Ooh, almost came up in corner, made some contact, but Davey has the spot.
Davey goes to fourth, Marlin back to fifth.
Sterling's car is just not running as it did, as well as it did before the pit stop.
Sterling led 189 laps of this race.
Probably has an excellent chance to lead the most laps with that 189 laps. I think it's pretty well assured that he will get the 5 bonus points for leading the most laps.
I see Davey trying to get alongside Jimmy Spencer, who's alongside of Bobby Hillen.
A lot of traffic.
Takes his by Spencer. Starcy takes the position away, but that was not for position.
Rusty's involved in some traffic too, signaling to some drivers behind him. Probably saying thank you for moving over and letting me by. Hut Strickland is just ahead in the McDonald's Ford, and ahead of Hut is Waldrop.
That's Kenny Wallace right in front of Rusty.
Rusty is really gaining on Ken Schrader now. Of course, Ken has been out there quite a while on the tires he has on his Kodiak Chevrolet. Dick Trickle going very slowly up the backstretch.
There's another indication of how faster you are on new tires. 104.7 was the speed before the pit stop, and 112 was the speed after the pit stop.
Well, Rusty just goes right by the Dirt Devil Pontiac.
Says hello to his brother as he goes by, probably.
Tell you what, Rusty's been something this year. Did I hear you say 5 top finishes after day one?
Yep, and he needs only to lead a few more laps. He will equal what he led in entire 1992. So it has been indeed a big, big comeback for the Rusty Wallace Miller Genuine Draft Tour. We'll be right back.
Why use Valvoline Motor Oil? It's the number one choice of Indy 500 Chief Mechanics. Daytona 500 Chief Mechanics. NHRA Mechanics. And Baja 1000 Mechanics. For use in their race cars and in their own cars. Any more questions? People who know use Valvoline.
From the days when they ripped through the sands of Daytona to tracks like Talladega and Darlington, racing fans have had a love affair with the drivers. To commemorate these heroes, Country Time presents our new collector series featuring Kulwicki, Gant, Shepard, Hamilton, Jarrett, and Darrell Waltrip. What better way to salute the men who risk it all on the speedway and the fans who make it all worthwhile?
Wow! I feel good!
When 280 seemed out of reach, it's Joe Amato and Autolite who punch it.
I feel good!
The wall goes to 290. Connie Coletta and Autolite smash it.
I feel good!
300, the barrier. Kenny Bernstein and Autolite shatter it. Autolite and the record breakers.
Wow! I feel good.
We feel pretty good about that.
more of the history in Wilkes County, North Carolina, in which North Wilkesboro, North Carolina Speedway is located. This is the Torrey Oak, located behind the courthouse, from whose limbs it is said that sympathizers with the crown were hanged during the Revolutionary War period. You can see that the recent snowstorm kind of damaged it, but what about that, Benny? Did they hang some people from
That's
the Torrey Oak?
That's pretty serious. Oh, caution flag.
I think we got debris on the racetrack.
A caution flag.
How about that's only the third one of the day. Rusty Wallace, by the way, had taken the lead from Ken Schrader before this caution came out, and this is how he did it.
We had those pressure tires, so basically it was uncontested. Schrader comes off the corner, Rusty drives alongside, takes his spot away.
It's going to be a break for Ken Schrader because he was going to have to make another pit stop, and now he'll get to do it under caution.
Yep, and we've got less than 100 laps to go, 97 to go, as a matter of fact, with 303 complete. This is the third caution of the day.
So they can all make it from here.
Yeah, bad break for Brett Bodine in the Quaker State Ford. He sat on the pole. He had just made a pit stop, was coming out of the pits when this caution flew.
He's in 18th right now. The debris on the track that has caused our caution, and the track crew waiting to run across the track and retrieve it.
Now we're going to see some races on pit road. All going to be in, changing four tires, and there they go.
Here comes Rusty. Only those on the lead lap now will be able to come in this time. Schrader is in, so is Allison, Marlin, and Kyle Petty. Now, Marlin's problem was the car was too tight. They'll try to... These are the two crews that have been doing the best job on pit road today. The Wallace team on top and the Allison crew on the bottom. And they are both doing superb. Oh, Allison, a great stop.
But Rusty Wallace is way down towards turn one. See,
right.
the position on the pit road makes a difference because Rusty drives out in front of Davey.
Rusty will be able to get out ahead of Davey and Kyle.
Kyle Pettis will come out third.
Ken Schrader, who came in second, is still on the jacket. That in turn one.
NASCAR official held them up there momentarily until the field could get back. 17.31 for Davey's crew on the pit stop. Good stop. Well, while we're under caution, we'll get a commercial break out of the way here at the First Union 400 at North Wilkesboro, North Carolina.
The people who design cars take a lot of things into consideration. Apparently, the installation of a custom sound system isn't one of them. Precisely why you should visit a Premier dealer. They're hand-picked for their attention to detail, commitment to service, and their extraordinary craftsmanship. Not to mention their rather deep sense of dedication.
Excuse me!
Great Northern Stereo on Shelburne Road is Vermont's authorized Premier Pioneer dealer.
Town & Country Honda in Montpelier recently received American Honda Motor Company's prestigious Master of Total Customer Satisfaction Award. What does this award mean for you? It's proof that when you come into Town & Country Honda, you'll be satisfied not only with your car buying experience, but with their expert service department. I know, I've purchased my last two Hondas from Town & Country, and I was treated so well, I'm marrying the owner.
The young and the not-so-young join two-time Olympic gold medalist Roger Kingdom in the biggest track and field meet in the world, the Penn Relay Carnival, Saturday afternoon at 4 Eastern, live on ESPN.
Still under caution at North Wilkesboro, ESPN Speed World coverage of the First Union 400. Well, Davey Allison had a 6.5-second pit stop, and rather a 17.31, and Rusty's crew had a 17.5-second pit stop.
Now, if Rusty had been, his crew had been a couple seconds slower, he would be second place to Davey Allison. And I tell you what, passing on these short tracks, as you've seen today, is very difficult.
He went into the pits in first place, and he's come out in first place. And here is an interesting statistic for me. Look at this. Already in the first seven races, he has led more laps this season than in all of 92. John?
Well, you know, walking up down pit road, watching the tire changes this afternoon, most of the teams are using sticker tires, brand new tires, but not Davey Allison. they are using scuff tires, tires that have got two laps on them. And Larry McReynolds says they have been very consistent for them all day long. So we might see Davey contend for the win. In fact, one of the crew people came up just a minute ago and said, hey, this is just like last year in reverse.
Here comes the field off corner number four. They get the green flag and we go back to racing on lap 309.
Boy, Ernie Irvin went out quick around Rick Wilson to get on the outside of him to follow Davey. Ernie was down on the inside where the left cars were supposed to be.
Looked like he's going to try to pass Davey on the outside then.
I thought so too.
Rusty's jumped out to a pretty good lead over Davey, but Davey closes in now as he has cleared the traffic.
You know, one thing's going to happen in this race. Pontiac has won two, Ford has won two, and Chevrolet has won two of the six races so far, so this will break the tie as far as wins, as far as manufacturers are concerned.
Yeah, that battle is as good as the battle among the drivers.
And right now we've got Fords and Pontiacs in the first four spots.
They turned a lap a little more than 114 and a half miles an hour last time. 114.6.
Wow.
You compare that now with a 117.6 that was the new track record set in qualifying by Dale.
And Dale Jarrett just
stopped.
Something happened to his engine or something.
Yeah, he didn't get stopped, but boy, he slowed dramatically.
He's trying to get to the pits.
Jerry, what's the problem?
Dale just radioed that I got a bad vibration. Bad vibration. So he's going to slow it and bring it down pit road. Probably the engine, guys. Could be a long day.
Boy, he did create a log jam there on the backstretch. Everybody survived it. But, boy, he got off or the car quit running on him. And everybody had to get on the brakes to avoid running into the back.
Yes, we're coming off turn two. We can see how slow Dale Jarrett is. And Rick Wilson almost ran the way. He did run the back of him twice, as a matter of fact.
Yeah, I saw a puff of smoke from that car, I think, so let's see what they do. The car on the pit road, and it appears as if they're going to put it behind the wall, Jerry, right?
Well, they're pushing it down pit road. Grab Jimmy Maycar. Jimmy, what's the problem? It looks like something happened to the motor. He just said it started vibrating real bad, and looks like a little bit of oil running out of the bottom of it, so something must have happened to the motor.
That's a tough break for Dale Jarrett. Jimmy Maycar, the team headed back to the garage area. His day is over.
Yeah, Dale had run in the top 10 just about all race long. But now the Interstate Battery Chevy is behind the wall. 5th, 6th, 7th, 8th, and 9th here. Running nose to tail.
Sterling Marlin in 5th. Terry Labonte in 6th. Ricky Rudd in 7th. Darrell Walker in 8th. And Morgan Shepherd 9th. How many cars are in the big place?
I felt for Terry Labonte just a little bit. The Kellogg's Cornflake Chevrolet, they pointed towards this race. They felt like this was a race that they could win. They built a car for this racetrack, came up and tested a couple of times. They made pit stops here, and yesterday afternoon they blew the engine with 4 laps of practice. In that last hour, the happy hour, they only got 4 laps of practice. So really was disappointing.
Terry?
And Benny, you know, as you mentioned about Terry Labonte, they came here with 3 race cars and tested for 3 days. They practiced pit stops. They ran long runs. They ran short runs. They changed cars. They changed tires. Pete Wright and that crew at work pointing toward this race. They know Terry likes this racetrack, but it's all going to come up a little bit short today.
Ricky Rudd and Darrell Waltrip are battling for position. Waltrip to the inside of Ricky, but Rudd holds him off for the moment. We'll continue with our live coverage from North Wilkesboro as Rusty Wallace is looking for his 3rd win of the 93 season.
A hot new peanut just rode into town with a spicy taste that's getting everybody all fired up.
Got some warm.
Maybe you ought to practice. With Mild.
Try new Planters Heat in Mild and Hot.
Why use Valvoline Motor Oil? For their race cars and their own cars, Valvoline is the number one choice of race mechanics from Indy 500 to Daytona 500 to NHRA to Baja to SCCA.
Major League excitement.
5 nights a week
on ESPN.
This week on America's Game of the Week, Andy Van Slyke leads the Pirates against Daryl Strawberry and the Dodgers. Tonight, live on ESPN Sunday Night Baseball.
Rusty Wallace leaves the First Union 400 at the end of 323 laps. And his advantage is about 88 hundredths of a second over Davey Allison. Kyle Petty's almost 2 seconds behind. Schrader a little over three. And Marlin is 5 seconds behind in fifth position.
And folks, you won't believe it, but Bob Jenkins does that himself. I mean, with a little computer here, he hits the button to get those numbers. And Bob,
what do you mean you won't believe that?
I mean, I can't believe that you're doing a great job.
Something that involves numbers, usually I have problems with.
Exactly.
This is just hit the button. Why, it's pretty easy.
Well, this battle continues here with Sterling Marlin running in fifth place. Terry Labonte in sixth. Ricky Rudd there in seventh place. Morton Shepherd right behind him in eighth place.
And we see that Rudd and Morgan Shepherd disposed of Darrell Walsh and went up and caught this group.
These guys look like they're tied together with a chain almost. Now Labonte inside Marlin on this front stretch. Labonte won this race back in 1988. He won the fall race in 87.
This one broke for Junior Johnson, I believe. Right.
Yes, he did win the race with Junior Star.
Fifth, sixth, seventh, and eighth right here.
Darrell, you see him back there. This car doesn't seem to be working quite as good now as it was a little bit earlier. Might be a little bit tight, but as it run on, that might work to his favor. Here's Shepherd going up on the outside of Ricky Rudd. Hey, look at that. Made a good run. Got a bite off of that turn. Rudd going to race him into turn three, but Shepherd just driving right on in there.
Yeah. He made that look pretty easy on the outside.
Yeah.
Sterling Marlin, by the way, has picked up the 5 bonus points for leading the most laps, but it appears as if his chance to win his first NASCAR Winston Cup event, well, the chances aren't as good as they were a while ago, because he was leading this race and dominating it for a while. Now back to fifth, and there is the leader, Rusty Wallace. There's the 52 car.
Jimmy Means.
Now, Hurley Limo is on the quarter panel there in the back, but on the front of it is another interesting sponsor story.
Race Fans Incorporated, which is just a group of race fans. They're interested in getting new members to their club. There's an 800 number on the back of the car. You can read it. And they're happy to have you join up, and they do their funds go into helping Jimmy Means in a sponsorship form.
And the administrative fee is, I mean, there is a small administrative fee for that, but I don't think it's anything substantial at all.
No.
I thought you'd think about it. And look at Morgan, he's passed the 5 on the outside. Now he's passed the 14 on the outside.
Now Ricky Rudd looks up there and says, hey, wait a minute, there's something going on here. I got passed up there, why don't I try to do it?
There's the last lap, 109.8, and the comparison between that and the pole speed.
Rudd is not able to do it as easily as Morgan Shepherd. As a matter of fact, Rudd wasn't able to do it at all.
67 laps to go.
Move Shepherd into the sixth position. Kenny Schrader is still fourth. Rusty leads. Davey Allison second, Kyle Petty third. Ken Schrader is fourth. Sterling Marlin is fifth. Now Shepherd trying to take it away from him. He is sixth. Boy, he's getting that outside through working.
Well, it sure is. It is working for him. He moves alongside of Sterling now, trying to take over fifth.
Ooh, got a little high that time. Couldn't quite do it, but he'll run up there again and turn 1 and 2. This is where he's done his best work on the outside. Ooh, they went in there both a little hard, but Shepherd now.
Well, he's going to do it.
He passed all three of those cars. Whoa, here comes Sterling back.
Yeah, the turns 3 and 4 is not as good, the outside groove up there, as it is in turns 1 and 2. But he didn't lose any ground. In fact, he gained a little bit, so he Jr. now has the position. That's fifth place.
Morgan successfully has moved to fifth position in the outside line. And here's the leader. You're riding with him, Rusty Wallace. We'll be right back.
We started a revolution in the streets. And now it's hitting the water. Introducing the Yamaha Wave Blaster. Essentially, it's the world's most radically advanced bike. Now available on the water.
Service and auto repair under.
The day I get in my car, won't start. No small problem, right? Well, I figure it's the battery. So I go down to the AutoZone and I tell them what I need. The guy says to me, let's check your old one first. It might not be the problem. Turns out he was right. All I needed was a new battery cable. Talk about saving money. Now you tell me, would another parts store done that? They made sure I got exactly what I needed. Now I'll remember that. Believe me, I will.
Good crowd on hand here at North Wilkesboro. They're enjoying the wonderful weather, bright sunshine, and they're also enjoying a great Winston Cup race. Here at North Wilkesboro, there are the top five, and again, how they are separated. Rusty Wallace with a 7.25 second lead on the top five places right now. Kyle Petty seems to be the guy who was making up the most distance right now.
He is definitely gaining on Davey Allison. You can see he has closed right in on him. He was more than a second behind. That's not a second the distance that we see there. Look at him drive into the turn. He drives in a little bit deeper than Davey. The car sticks down on the inside, so he is coming.
From 22nd to 4th to 6th, moved to 3rd at lap 315, and at the present time, lap 342, he holds on to 3rd spot, but is challenging or is about to catch the second place, Davey Allison.
He's really picking up time going into turn three. He really drives it deep down on the inside to come up on Bobby Hillam's Highland cars. Kyle has to go high here. Let's see how that'll affect him because he's been running right down on the bottom of the racetrack. Didn't seem to affect him too much there. Stayed about the same distance behind Davey. But watch him pick it up going into turn three here.
He just closes right up on the bumper of Allison.
Right in the middle of that corner where he does all that damage to Davey. If Davey goes up the hill a little bit right here, he's going to get past. You see Mark Martin slow.
Now Mark just moves completely out of the way, let off on the gas and let those guys go and race for their position. He knows that he's out of it and he's not going to foul up anybody else who's out there running for the win.
32nd position, Mark is. Now there is Rusty Wallace, and if points were awarded right now, he would be the new points leader in NASCAR Winston Cup. We saw the interval there between first and second and third as, once again, Kyle runs strong in the third and fourth turns.
Man, oh man.
Rusty would have an 18-point lead on Dale Earnhardt if points were awarded right now. Earnhardt currently running in the 16th spot.
Here comes Kyle, trying to get on the bottom. Davey trying desperately to keep him back there.
Rusty just led his 68th lap.
That was Rusty, and here is second and third. That's the real battle on the racetrack.
Once again, Kyle tries to get alongside Davey. Can't quite make it.
Darrell Walton has moved around Ricky Rudd back in the pack for eighth position. Rudd now dropped back to ninth. Nine cars on the lead lap.
Earnhardt just let him by. But the Black is Back theme certainly is continuing this weekend. The black and yellow, Miller Genuine Draft leading. The black and red, Haviland Ford second. The black and green, Mellow Yellow, Pontiac is third.
I guess Black has won every race except for Morton Shepherd winning in Atlanta.
Atlanta, yep.
Here's Kyle. He's got a nose up there. He might get him this time, baby.
He's got a nice run. No traffic right in front of him.
No, I don't. I hope I don't have to say in both of them spin. Nope, I didn't.
Well, Davey's strong off of the turn, though. But here's where Kyle does his best work. He's going into that turn three, and as Benny said, right through the middle of the turn.
Davey goes back pretty strong. He's pretty equal.
Davey has the first half of the racetrack, and Kyle has the second half. Now, I don't know. Kyle may have him this time.
Kyle couldn't accelerate full off of that turn. Yeah. The car was going to break loose with him because he didn't have the right angle off the turn. Now he gets a little bit more there coming off the turn.
Yeah.
There you go.
Whoa! Look out.
Look at Kyle.
Davey really did a good job of saving it.
He looked Steve Kinzer going through the first turn, didn't he?
Here's Morgan Shepherd passing Davey Allison, and that is for position.
Power sliding through the corner.
Kenny Schrader went by, took over third. Morgan now taking over fourth. Well, that was some great driving.
Boy, he cost him some positions, but boy, was that fun to watch.
How in the world? Let's see if we can figure anything out here now. Here they come off the corner. They come off the fourth corner. Now Davey tries to get underneath Kyle. Kyle goes down and gets bumped in the rear. Davey hits the brakes and turns away from Kyle Petty. And both of them go down. And he's up next to the wall and Kyle.
Dirt track.
Man, oh man.
That was unbelievable.
Jim Roper, the old dirt track racer, would have been proud of that. But one thing you got to be concerned about there is, boy, they used up some tires right there.
Yeah.
Sideways like that. They didn't flat spot them because they kept them rolling. But it heated them up more than they were.
And the concern that you have is if Kyle Petty getting up in that loose stuff.
Of course, Rusty Wallace, while all that was going on, man, he just drove away from him and has picked himself up a good lead.
Remains in second spot, but what a ride he had up toward the first turn wall. Rusty continues to lead here with 358 laps completed. We'll be right back.
Why use Valvoline motor oil? It's the number one choice
available to anyone with residence or...
Welcome back to this special Hall of Fame edition of NHRA Today. And sadly, Dave McClellan, three of our inductees tonight are no longer with us. Mm-hmm. And it seems like only yesterday that Joe Pagazzano was out there thrashing on that funny car.
And you know, I can remember the days of Jungle Jim Lieberman with Jungle Pam out directing traffic. And Lieberman was coming back at what seemed to be 60 miles an hour after a burnout. And John Bandemir Sr. trying to carve a mountain into a drag strip and was ultimately successful.
With that said, let's take a closer look at the professional lives of the three gentlemen we just mentioned.
It would be easy to say that John Bandemir Sr. was ahead of his time. Case in point, the first NHRA national event at Great Bend, Kansas. When most race cars were driven or flat-towed, John showed up with his racer in a tractor-trailer rig, a good 30 years before it became standard equipment on professional race teams.
When you visit some portions of Wilkes County, North Carolina, this is the home of Robert Cleveland, a gentleman farmer and his family of 17. It was built in the 1770s in Purlier in western Wilkes County, moved to Wilkesboro, and remained behind the old jail. Colonel Benjamin Cleveland, who was Robert's brother, led forces from this region to the Battle of Kings Mountain during the Revolutionary War.
And Bob, I pass that house going to school every day.
Is that right?
Huh.
Well, Rusty Wallace is still in command of the first Union 400. Here's the interval back to second place. And there's Kyle. Third is Schrader. Fourth, Shepherd. Fifth, Davey. Sixth, Terry Labonte. And seventh is Sterling Marlin.
And in eighth place is Darrell Waltrip. And Ricky Rudd is ninth. Those are the nine cars that are on the lead lap. And in the 10th position, one lap down, is Bill Elliott. Jimmy Hensley, good run going here today, and the Kawicki racing car is in 11th place. He also is one lap down. In 12th place is Ernie Irvin in car number 4. He is 2 laps down.
Here's a field. We'll show you graphically where they are, and then you can see where they are on the racetrack as we lock down the shot here and have the field pass under our camera in turn 1. Looks for his second straight win and his 24th of his career.
This would be his third victory this year, correct?
Yep. This year, second in a row.
No other driver has more than one.
There's Rick Mast in car number 1. He's shown in 18th position. 4 laps down. Mast, 100th career Winston Cup start. And there's Wally Dallenbach in the Keystone car. Number 16, where's he?
He's
20th, okay. Jimmy Means,
27th.
Back of him,
Phil Parsons is 19th, the Mannheim Auto Auction car.
Brother Phil.
Then comes Kyle Petty, who is in second place in the little yellow Pontiac.
The 4 car of Ernie Irvin you see back there is 2 laps down in 12th spot. He started the race basically 2 laps down, was involved on that first lap crash.
Yeah, he began the race 3rd, but before the first lap was completed, he was in a wreck.
There's a 3rd place car, Denny Schrader, Kodiak Chevrolet.
Here's one of the Rookie of the Year contenders, Kenny Wallace. And because Jeff Gordon crashed out very early, both Wallace and Bobby Labonte will pick up points on Jeff.
And he's 15th. Kenny Wallace is 15th. Morgan Shepherd is 4th.
Morgan Shepherd is 4th. And Brett Bodine, the pole setter there now, is in 16th position. He is 4 laps behind the leader.
There's the 5th place car of Davey Allison. Avalon Ford, defending champion of this event.
6th place car of Terry Labonte is the next car on the racetrack.
Showing us some battle scars there on the left side. Kellogg's Cornflake. Oh boy, look at this. Good luck. There is Rick Wilson, first of all. Sterling Marlin.
23rd.
Marlin.
And Sterling Marlin is...
Come on, Benny.
7th.
7th.
Darrell.
Darrell is 8th.
Hutt.
Hutt, I don't know where he is.
He's 24th.
24th, thank you, Ned.
Ricky.
Ricky Rudd is he's the only the last car on the lead lap.
How about Earnhardt?
I remember Ned said that a minute ago. He's 17th.
Bobby Hamilton
is 29th.
Behind him is
Mark Martin. He's 31st.
And how about Michael?
Michael Waltrip is
21st.
Thank you, Ned. And Bobby Labonte, I saw him back there. He is 25th.
There he is.
The Maxwell House Ford.
Bobby Labonte.
Kenny Wallace is the top rookie in this race so far.
Yep.
15th.
There's Jeff Bodine. He is 28th currently, and the 7th car is currently 10th.
And Harry Gant
is 13th. Bobby Hillen in the 90 car is 26th. Myers Furniture car. Never see Bill Elliott and Ted Musgrave. Bill Elliott currently running 11th, and Ted Musgrave is
22nd
running 3rd.
He did pretty good though. Rusty completes lap 378. 22 to go. We did miss 2 cars as we're making our pan back. The number 98 car we missed. That, of course, is Derek Cope.
He's 30th.
There's the driver snapshot showing you that Rusty started 9th, currently 1st. His highest lap was on 378. He took over the lead, and the lowest he has been was on lap 141. He was in 10th place at that time. He's led 90.
Oh, trouble up here. Jimmy Hensley has hit the wall and spun into the wall. Jimmy was running in the 10th position.
Caution comes out for the fourth time this afternoon, and Derek gets the car down off the rudder, Jimmy, and gets the car down off the bank and continues running. Jimmy Hensley.
Yeah. We'll see some pit stops. You can see some damage done to the car. Let's see what did happen. Earnhardt down on the inside of him and clips him just a little bit going into the turn and shoots him around. Harry Gant almost hit him, but he was able to get by. Didn't look like Hensley hit the wall too hard, but
did a little bit of damage there on the left rear. Not a whole lot, but a little. Meanwhile, the leader of the race, Rusty Wallace, is coming in. So is second place Kyle.
Third place Schrader. Coming in.
Yep.
Davey's coming in.
So yeah. Is Morgan.
They'll all have to. Once the leader came in, they all had to come in.
Well, they stopped at about the same time, so we'll see who is the quickest. Rusty's crew moves to the other side of the car faster than Kyle.
Yeah, he's going to get out. If they don't have a miscue on the left side, he'll be out far in advance because he's further down pit road. Well, Kyle's down and gone. That surprised me. Yeah, great pit stops.
About 19.5 seconds for Kyle Petty. Setting up now for the finish of this race, less than 20 to go. We remain under caution because of a spin involving Jimmy Hensley.
Both the meetings will return.
200 for the year. He's had. Let's take a look at the contributions those with us tonight have made to the sport of drag racing.
Lou Bainey has to be considered one of the most diverse of the 1993 inductees. As a driver, Lou cut his teeth in roadsters on Southern California ovals, and on the dry lakes, he broke numerous records for coupes. As a promoter, he and Louis Center opened up Saugus Drag Strip back in 1950. It was the first track to offer night racing. As a team owner, he played an important role in the careers of Don Prudhomme, Tom McEwen, and Kenny Arnold. Bainey also served as general manager
for individual.
To become chef.
Tom Fisher with the nimble fingers over there.
Wouldn't you rather have a
dispute in its favor?
When you see what
game to where to get some offense, and they're just running up and down and playing again. Right.
Maybe you have what it takes to be one of us. The few, the proud, the Marines.
No.
Not
I know the answer to that because
not Benny.
No, wasn't Benny.
Okay.
No, wasn't Benny. It was Tom Dooley. Jerry?
And Frank Edwards is the favorite down here in the pit. Western Auto Mechanic of the race. Frank, who is married to the mayor of Middleburg, North Carolina, which happens to be his wife. And before you guys yucked it up upstairs. That's right. And Frank from Middleburg, North Carolina, is Western Auto Mechanic of the race. Please, Frank.
Congratulations to Frank. Here we go with 16 laps to go.
Darrell Walton was the guy who made up the most ground on that pit stop. He was running eighth coming in. He came out fifth.
Rusty Wallace trying to hang on. Everybody is equal now. They've all got fresh tires on. Kyle Petty is chasing him. So is Rick Kenny Schrader.
Jamie Allison.
Kyle's car doesn't seem to go quite as well on new tires. He seems to pick up a little bit after the run a while, and they don't have a while to run.
No, they don't. This thing is about over with. Just fourth to go. We're going to declare a winner.
It looks like Rusty is just going to drive away from these boys. Looks like he really has things going.
Rusty's never won this race, but he did win the fall race in 1988.
That's what you love to see out of the rearview mirror. Distance.
Yes.
Right.
Nothing.
Nothing. Man, when you see the whites of their eyes, you know you got problems.
Boy, there's a big pack of cars running together here, including Phil and Morgan Shepherd and Terry Labonte and Ricky Rudd.
Ooh.
Brett Budine got caught up in a shuffle and lost about 10 cars past him, and it wasn't in position. The other dudes are heavy.
Here's Schrader.
Now, battle for second. Schrader trying to take second away from Kyle.
Oh. And we've seen that happen a couple of times today when it didn't come off that easy. Kyle keeps his car right on the bottom of the racetrack. If Schrader's going by, I think he's going to have to do it on the outside. But can he with these tires as fresh as they are? I doubt it.
Schrader has his best run of the year going. He was fourth at Darlington. That's been his best finish so far in 93.
10 laps to go.
Kyle Petty finished third at Bristol. He's now second. And Rusty continues to open up the interval. Now 9 to go.
Rusty just keeps putting a little distance on him all the time.
Rusty looking for his 9th short track win. In the last 6 races, he's been 1st, 2nd, 3rd, 5th, 1st, and 1st. Maybe.
Chris Kyle is 2nd, 3rd is Schrader, 4th is Davey Allison, 5th, Darrell Waltrip, 6th is Terry Labonte, 7th, Ricky Rudd, Morton Jeopardy, 8th, and Sterling Marlin, 9th. Those are the 9 cars on the lead lap. Bill Elliott is 1 lap down in 10th position.
Rusty and these guys and his buddy Parrott and that crew, they have done themselves a job this year so far.
They sure have.
Man. Will be the new Winston Cup point leader?
Yep.
Even that flip done in Daytona, the very first race of the year.
Yeah. Forgot about that, but you're right.
What a comeback, huh?
396. Our computer when he crossed the line. There it is. 4 to go. Rusty Wallace, if he wins, he will move to 19th on the all-time win list in NASCAR Winston Cup competition, and it will tie him with Joe Weatherly.
Just 3 laps.
Terry Labonte and Ricky Rudd are still battling for position.
That's 6th and 7th.
Rusty will get the white flag next time around.
Kyle Petty is pulled away from Ken Schrader.
Here he comes off the 4th corner. Joel Ford's got that flag in his hand. He starts waving it.
One more to go for Rusty Wallace, and he'll win his 24th career NASCAR Winston Cup race, 2nd straight, 3rd this season, and become the new points leader in NASCAR Winston Cup competition. Here's the Miller Genuine Miller Genuine Draft Pontiac off the 4th corner. Rusty raises the hand, and he wins the first Union 400. Here's the battle won by Terry Labonte over Ricky Rudd. And the Miller Genuine Draft Pontiac crew celebrates another win. Rusty Wallace headed for Victory Lane here at North Wilkesboro, and we will be back to talk with him in just a moment. Stay with us. We'll be right back.
What does it take to be a mountain man? Do you need a big horse? Do you need a deep tan? Do you have to have a saddle? Do you have to have the gear? Well, the simple truth is you just gotta have the beer.
Busch Beer, an easy drinking Busch Light. Have you got what it takes to be a mountain man?
What does it take to live a mountain man's life? Get a smooth bush berry, the drinking bush light.
Why use Valvoline Motor Oil? For their race cars and their own cars, Valvoline is the number one choice of race mechanics, from Indy 500 to Daytona 500 to NHRA to Baja to SCCA.
Say your eyes are red, irritated, dry? Don't hide them. Help them with Clear Eyes. It gets rid of the redness and has an extra moisturizing ingredient, too. Clear Eyes. And for allergies and colds, Clear Eyes ACR.
The biggest names in sports are on ESPN Radio.
Hershey walks around Donnie.
That was what you're supposed to.
David Frost, this is his third shot hitting. In a moment for the green.
You see how far short it is, Pat. This is, being the green small, you got to have it some loft, but this is something you're going to have a little bump and run. It's 55 yards. This ball will hit the green and then start running. Well played.
Pretty good shot.
That will elevate himself and the car to victory lane here at North Wilkesboro. Rusty has done it again. And just a moment ago, as he did after winning the race at Bristol, in recognition of his longtime friend and the fallen champion from NASCAR Winston Cup Racing in 92, Rusty took a Polish victory lap. Well, while that car is being elevated, let's look at the unofficial results. He beat Kyle Petty, Ken Schrader, Davey Allison, and a good run by Darrell Waltrip. Davey, by the way, started 27th, finished 4th. Second five, Terry Labonte, Rudd, Morgan Shepherd, Sterling Marlin, and Bill Elliott.
11th through 20th, Ernie Irvin, Jimmy Hensley, Harry Gant, Jimmy Spencer, Kenny Wallace. Top rookie today in 15th position.
16th through 20th, Dale Earnhardt, Brett Bodine, Phil Parsons, Rick Mast, and Michael Waltrip. Earnhardt falling out of the point lead.
Dahlenbach, Strickland, Wilson, Musgrave, and Labonte, 21 through 25.
And 26 through 30 are Hillen, Means, Jeff Bodine, Hamilton, and Derek Cope.
And the last four starters, Mark Martin, Dale Jarrett, Dick Trickle, and Jeff Gordon.
Rusty has made his way to victory lane with a big smile on his face. And here he goes. Rusty climbs out of the car. Here's Jerry.
And they're high-fiving in victory lane. Rusty Wallace, congratulations on your second win in a row.
Thanks a lot. The crew did a wonderful job. You know, we were still want to remember Alan for what happened there, you know. But the crew did a wonderful job today, and I got to hand it to them. I talked to Penske last night. Roger said, drive smart, man. Just drive smart. We can win this title. So I try to drive real smooth today and avoid all the accidents. But this was for the crew. They did a great job in the pit stops today.
Again, great pit stops. And you also just took the point lead over from Dale Earnhardt.
Well, it's going to be a heck of a race, and I don't wish him any bad luck or nothing. And we're just racing hard. And so I'm sure Martin's going next week.
Indeed he will. Here is Buddy Parrott and the crew hugging Rusty Wallace, and they're part of this victory here at Oak Wilkesboro Speedway.
Welcome back to North Wilkesboro, North Carolina, in just a moment and show you the unofficial point standings as Rusty has done it again.
At Yamaha, we've always left the competition in the dust. And now it's time they took a bath. Introducing the Yamaha Pro VXR, the world's leading personal watercraft. When it comes to acceleration, we're flat out better.
For those who like to spend lots of time and effort cleaning, shining, and protecting your tires, this is going to be difficult to watch. Because with no-touch tire care, you don't need to rubber wipe your tires to make them look great. It's true. You just spray it on and leave it alone. No touching. Now, we know it's hard, but you've got to fight it. Come on, you can do it. That's good. No-touch tire care. The best touch is no touch.
We've had Old Blaze for 16 years. I mean, this Old Blaze. My husband uses it for all of his hunting and fishing trips. He and the dog absolutely love that car. Someday, when even AC Delta Parts can't keep it going, He'll just park it out back so he and the dog can sit in it and reminisce.
AC Delco Parts. It's like buying time.
Now through May 15th, get started with up to $14 cash back on Delco Freedom batteries.
Hear the quest for the Cup point standings now. After the seventh race, Rusty is on top. The man that made the biggest jump, Kyle Petty, who went from eighth to fourth in the point standings. Our Speed World coverage being brought to you by Valvoline. People who know use Valvoline. By your local Yamaha dealer, who invites you to see their exciting line of motorcycles, ATVs, and water vehicles. And by Smooth Bush Beer and easy drinking Bush Light, the official beer of NASCAR. Well, we'll be on the air a week from Monday night with our delayed coverage of the Haynes 500 from Martinsville Speedway in Virginia. We thank you for joining us today. Rusty Wallace has won the first Union 400 here in North Wilkesboro. For Ned Jarrett, Benny Parsons, John Kernan, and Dr. Jerry Punch, this is Bob Jenkins. So long, everyone.